Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, and a very, very big welcome to members of the public who have joined us this afternoon for our public meeting. My name is Jo Williams. I'm chair of the Care Quality Commission. And today is rather different and somewhat exciting for us. We are being transmitted live onto YouTube Live. And so I hope that people who are interested in our affairs will find this afternoon's proceedings helpful and interesting. I apologize for my voice, but I hope that during the afternoon, others will help me by making contributions. And I'm joined by colleagues who are board members and also executive members of CQC. I'd just like to make it clear to members of the public that we are pleased that you're here. We're not able to take questions directly, but if there are specific issues that you wish to raise, we'd be very pleased to hear from you at the end of the meeting, and we'll do our best to address those issues. So on that basis, I think I've reminded people to switch off their phones. We'll start the meeting. So, first of all, our first item is declaration of commissioner interests.
I have to declare an interest as a board member of New Lawn Housing Trust, which is delivers services which are inspected by the CQC, regulated by the CQC.
Thank you.
I'd like to declare two interests, one of them relating to my academic role. I'm evaluating an improvement intervention at Barking, Havering and Redbridge Trust, which is one of the trusts that CQC is involved in. I'd also like to declare just this once the fact that I am a GP, and clearly there's a relationship between that and our Tranche 5 registration process. Since I'm a salaried doctor, I'm assuming that I don't have any business conflict of interest here.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. If I could move us on now to item three of the agenda, which are the minutes of the public board meeting, which was held on the 16th of May in Bristol. I intend now to take them page by page for accuracy. So page one.
Just on point two. Could it be amended that I was not able to attend rather than I would not attend, please?
Okay, we'll take that amendment. Thank you. Page two. Page three. Page four. Page five. Page six. Page seven. Page 8, page 9, page 10, and page 11. Okay. In that case, I'm not hearing any further comments, subject to that one amendment raised by Kay Sheldon. I will assign those minutes as a true record of our meeting on the 16th of May. Item four, I'd ask colleagues if there are any matters arising that they wish to raise in relation to those minutes. Martin.
On page five, the second bullet point under item 33, talk about delays in the implementation of the Enhanced Bank of Clinical and Professional Associates. Would it be possible to have a very brief update as to what's going on, a little bit more detail?
Could I ask Amanda, Philip King, to respond?
Yes, thank you, Martin. The bank is up and running, and it has been now for several months. We are in the process of evaluating that. The early indication seems to be that they're being well used within the operations. It is early days, but the evaluation of that work should be reporting sometime later on this year.
Anything further?
Yep. Item 16 on page 10. Now that I'm back in action, I would welcome the opportunity to get more involved in the involvement, as it were, in my capacity as a board member.
Thank you very much. Anything further on the minutes and matters arising? Okay, and I'd ask if board members would receive the action log. That now takes us to item five, and this is an opportunity for myself and commissioners to report back to the board. If I begin by telling the board that David Behan and I, the new chief executive, attended the Health Select Committee just last week. It was our annual accountability meeting, and it was an opportunity for the Health Select Committee to raise questions about the overall performance of CQC. And I imagine that it will be a matter of several weeks before their final report is published. Deirdre Kelly to report back on the Audit and Risk Committee.
And thank you very much, Chair. Thank you very much, Chair. Good afternoon. This report from the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee covers two meetings, which we held in July and September, and summarises the actions that we've been taking over the last 3 months. You have the report before you. I hope you'll find it self-explanatory. I wish just to raise one or two items, draw to your attention. One of the big pieces of work we did was to consider how best to support the newly created and evolving Healthwatch England in terms of managing their governance and risk. And we discussed this at both our meetings and agreed that the most cost-effective way of helping them do this was to include them in the activities of a current Audit and Risk Assurance Committee rather than set up a separate committee with a separate membership board, but that we would be very clear that the governance would be discussed separately for Healthwatch and separately for CQC, and later on in the agenda there's the terms of reference for you to agree. I'm pleased to say that Anna Bradley, who unfortunately can't be with us this afternoon, did join us at the second ARAC meeting, and she was content with this plan, and I think it will be an effective way of using our very short resources and being efficient. The second point I'd like to raise is the position with internal audit within the organisation. The board has heard on a number of occasions from this committee that we are concerned that a number of the internal audits in the organisation still only provide partial assurance. The only two with substantial assurance were finance and HR, which I think is testament to both those directorates and how well they manage their business, but the rest of the audits over time have had partial assurance or less than that. We do appreciate that some of the systems and processes within the organisation are still evolving, but nevertheless, I think it's a point that the committee wanted me to draw the board's attention to, that we're still not complete with assurance. However, on the positive side, from the previous audits, 99% of the management actions had been completed. I think that's quite significant considering the amount of action plans and activity the organisation is undertaking with different scrutinies and reviews. And I'll say this because I believe very firmly that the internal audits are there to make the organisation more effective. So the fact the management actions are completed is a very good sign. I'd also like to raise the issues of the risk registers, which again we will be raising the strategic risk register later on in the meeting. The Audit and Risk Assurance Committee have commissioned a number of risk workshops in order for the board and the executive to refresh our risk register in line with our new refresh strategy and strategic objectives. We've had two risk workshops to date. The third one will be on the 17th of October, which is fast becoming a very busy day. I just mark that out for the executive, that everyone seems to want to have their item on the 17th of October, but the third and final workshop will be on the morning of the 17th of October, And I very much hope that we will then complete the work on the strategic risk register for the board's everyday use in line with the strategic direction. And that once that's in place, the corporate risk register will fall into place and be updated. A very important item which we considered was that of information governance. Obviously, for an information-rich organisation as ourselves, the management of information governance and securities is extremely important and a very significant risk to the organisation. We had an update at this meeting, and a further update will be provided at the next meeting with a commentary on where the management action plan came. However, I think the committee was satisfied that good progress was being made, that the main risks had been identified as being related to human error, which I think is well known with regard to information, and we were reassured that training and education programs were being established, and I hope we'll find how effective that is. The last point that I wish to raise is that of the ARAC third-party commissioned review. We have commissioned a review of the regulatory processes and investigations at Morecambe Bay, Barking and Havering, in order to inform our investigative methodology, process and regulatory decisions. Following considerable discussion, this review will be in three parts. The first part is commissioned by the Chief Executive, and he may wish to speak about this now or later. I think it's in your report, David. And the second part is commissioned by ARAC. We've now identified a supplier, and a contract has been signed with Deloitte to carry out this work over a six-week period. The third phase fits in with what Martin has been doing with Philip and others in reviewing the regulatory model. So I think this is a very important piece of work. I'm pleased that we had significantly good tenders from suppliers to do this work. It is obviously absolutely key to our function that we are constantly evaluating our processes and ensure that we're serving our patients and the public appropriately. And this, we obviously will report that in due course. Finally, the Deloitte, who are work with NAO as our external auditors, presented the final management letter. It had been delayed for various reasons, partly internal organisational reasons and partly due to changes in how we managed our business with the move to NHS shared services. So we only got the management letter rather late in September. But what I would like to draw the board's attention to was that there was an addendum to their audit completion report which looked at governance structures and board effectiveness, effective risk management and regulatory risk. We felt this was very timely. It would form the basis for our board development program going forward, and it's already been taken on board, Alison, as part of the work for the Corporate Governance Framework project. And I hope all of you received copies of that, because we did request that it was sent out, but it was a very helpful summary for future use. So thank you, Chair. I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Deirdre. Are there any questions for Deirdre? Okay.
Just firstly to say that it was very helpful to have such a full report, so thank you for that. And also thank you for being sort of honest and open about the sort of current situation and areas that we need to improve. So that's very welcome from my perspective. What I wanted to particularly ask is, we're obviously on a journey and there are some areas for improvement, and whether you had a sense that we're going to get there, you know, whether you've got the sort of confidence in our capability and capacity to get to a position where I guess we'd want to be.
Perhaps, Kay, you'd enlighten me by which specific area you'd like us to be. Do you mean with governance? Do you mean with risk?
You particularly mentioned that we had partial assurance in a number of the audits. So, you know, that's what I was particularly thinking.
That's very helpful. Yeah. With regard to the audits, the key area that's missing, and David and I have discussed this, and I think we discussed it openly at the meeting, was that of management assurance and making sure that there was sufficient performance management and systems and processes in place to be clear precisely what was happening and why things were not happening. And that's, I think, is work in progress, David. And I think, I don't know whether you wish to add to that.
No, I think, Kay, I think your question goes to the heart in a sense. Of course, there's an internal assurance process, and Deirdre is chairing that, and there's a programme, and the resources which the organisation has devoted to this is carrying, discharging that programme. Running in parallel to that, I think this plays to Deirdre's update on 95% of actions are completed. There needs to be a management response to those internal audits. But I also think there needs to be a proactive management response. I don't think we should wait for internal audit to tell us that there's some management processes that are not in place. I think managers, as managers, we need to start taking responsibility for making sure they are in place. And then the internal audit becomes the fail-safe, the wicket-keeper, would be the metaphor I would use, rather than the first line of approach to this. And so in a sense, my ambition would be managerially, the executive team, Malcolm's here as our deputy for the Northern Region, and his colleagues and other managers throughout the system begin to ensure that the systems that are in place are being used, and where those systems don't work, we change them and improve them and develop them. And then the internal audit function, and indeed the external audit function, is there to provide exactly that assurance that these are systems which are fit for purpose and indeed are working. So I think it's a work in progress, and there's been some hugely important work done by Deirdre and the Audit and Risk Committee to get us to this stage, and I think those seminars have provided a forum in which some of the key issues have been teased out, and this final one is an important one, just to make sure we can actually set up CQC for this next phase of its development with an audit and risk function alongside a management function, which is about driving forward.
And specifically, Deirdre, if I might, Kay was saying, do you believe that the improvement will is sustainable and will continue? I'm paraphrasing.
Thank you. Yes, very much so. I think that I would like to pay credit to the organisation. I think the risk management framework has been very much improved. I think more resource has come into the risk management. I think the Corporate Governance Framework Project Board has played a very important part in strengthening the position. And I think the direction of travel is one of considerable progress and optimism, Kay.
Any further comments? Well, thank you, Deirdre. We'll receive that report. Could I now ask you, Martin, to talk about the external expert reference group?
Yes, thank you, Chair. The board has identified our commitment to evaluating what we do and how we do it as a major priority for us. Indeed, it's one of our significant priorities that we put into our draft strategy, which is currently being consulted upon. To that end, the board will know that we've established an advisory group, an external advisory group, with some of the leading regulatory evaluators, not just from within the UK, but from outside the UK, on it to help us with this really quite complex process, remembering that the evaluation of regulatory function, in particular, does regulation make a difference, is a very complex job, which most other regulators have not even tried to take on. So this is a big task that we're doing, but a very important one to our success as an organisation. So we have identified two parallel work streams, one around internal evaluation and one around external commissioned evaluation. I'd like to specifically focus on the external work because that's an important framing for our overall programme. That work, we commissioned a three-month piece of work, which is being led by Professor Kieran Walsh from Manchester. What Kieran is doing is essentially looking at our regulatory model and making an assessment of why we made what decisions along the way. It's a really important process, so it's an academic critique of the decisions that we've made in determining and designing our regulatory model. And what he's doing is testing that those decisions against both best evidence in the field, international evidence in the field, and against the data that we have internally within the organisation. And as a result of that process, which should be finished by early December, he will come back to us through the advisory committee. He'll come back to the board with a series of recommendations about which areas we should focus our attention, our resources on in terms of detailed evaluation pieces of work So the board will be engaging with that. We're planning a workshop towards the end of the year for Kieran to present his results, and I think that's going to be a really important process. We'll then be able to really invest in detailed evaluation around the most important questions to us as an organisation.
Thank you, Martin. Are there any questions, comments? Okay, well, indeed, many, many thanks for that. Are there any other commissioners who wish to make any report backs to the board? Okay.
I mean, I just wanted to say how pleased I am to be back on the board after, well, I mean, I've always been on the board, but attending the board meetings after sort of 6 months, and I'm very pleased to be here and looking forward to contributing constructively as we go forward. So.
Oh, well, thank you, Kay, and we're delighted that you're with us. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. I'd like to, move on to item six, which refers to Healthwatch England and our Audit and Risk Assurance Committee. This is a decision paper, and we are asked as a board to do two things. Firstly, to approve the proposal that ARAC, the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee, oversees the scrutiny of audit and risk management by Healthwatch England in a separate meeting dedicated to Healthwatch England matters, and secondly, that the board approves the revised terms of reference of the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee. Now, Deirdre's already made mention, I think, of some of this, but Louise, I don't know whether you want to add anything, or I would invite Deirdre also, if you wish to make comment.
I may just start. I'm not going to address the ARAC issues, but I do want to just say that John Howard has agreed to be deputy chair, and that should really be reflected in the terms of reference.
Please, could you pick up the specific item?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Professor Kelly has already outlined for us the reasoning behind this piece of work that's been done. In the July board meeting, we were asked to go away and think about how we would incorporate audit and risk management of Healthwatch England into the CQC process, and how that could be done to maintain the separateness but togetherness of the two parts of the organisation. And as Professor Kelly has already outlined, the ARAC have considered on two occasions different options with regard to this, and have concluded that the options set out here, i.e. to have separate meetings, albeit on the same day, and to have Healthwatch England members of staff and the chair, of course, involved in the Healthwatch England element, and CQC members in the other element. That was the conclusion of the ARAC, and that is why you now have before you, board members, the terms of reference to be amended, taking into account the recent appointment of Mr. Howard.
Are there any questions, Martin?
Yeah, thank you. I agree with this. I think it's very good, a good recommendation. Just one minor point under item 2.4 on page 3. There's a reference here to the co-opted member from Healthwatch England being entitled to attend both parts of the ARAC meeting, both the CQC bit and the Healthwatch England bit. I think they should attend both parts, because that's an important part of joining the two organisations together.
If I just respond to that, thank you, Martin. I think the original suggestion was that they'd only come to the Healthwatch England bit, and then it was felt that that was inappropriate. If the independent members to ARAC were there for both, then the Healthwatch person should be for both. So perhaps we could just strengthen that. I thought we'd agreed that. Thank you.
If I'm right, I think usually that the chairs of organisations are not actually usually part of the committee. They can attend, but I don't know if we need to say anything about that in relation to the Healthwatch chair, because obviously she could attend, but I mean, maybe I've missed it, but she normally the chair wouldn't actually be a member of the committee.
I think we have covered that, actually. We've said that the chair of Healthwatch or CQC or the deputy chair of CQC could not be members of the committee, but could attend on invitation or by request. I'm pretty sure that's in there. I'm sure I saw that.
Chair, at 4.3.2,
The chair, CQC chair, will attend at least one Part 1 meeting per annum, may request to attend others. Similarly, the Healthwatch England chair will attend at least Part 2 meeting per annum and may request to attend others. So hopefully that establishes that they're not entitled to be members, but could, they will attend.
I think, to Kay's point, it's implied, but it's not explicit. And possibly it's worth just putting a sentence in saying that they are not members of the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee. I think we could add that. We could add that for sake of clarification. Pardon me, I've not switched my mic on. In the light of those comments, first of all, I think perhaps we should note in the minutes that John Harwood has been appointed and agreed to take on the role of Deputy Chair of the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee. But our task this afternoon is to approve the proposal that is set out in relation to the scrutiny of Healthwatch England. I know that the chair of Healthwatch England has been fully engaged in the discussion and is in agreement with the taking it forward in this way. So, members of the board, are you in agreement that we approve that? Thank you very much indeed. And secondly, that subject to a minor revision, we approve the revised terms of reference for ARAC. And that revision is just to clarify that the chairs of both Healthwatch England and CQC, and if and when there's a deputy chair of CQC, would not be members of those committees, but would be expected to attend at regular intervals. Thank you. I'll move us on now to item 7, which is the Chief Executive's report to the board. This is David Bean's first report as our new Chief Executive, and of course we're delighted that you're with us, David, and we're looking forward to what you have to say this afternoon. Thank you.
Jo, thank you. So I'm doing 5 things in this report. I'm saying a little bit about how I intend to spend my time over the period to the end of December. I think the past 4 weeks has really seen me working on the publication of the strategy with other colleagues that have been working on this for a longer period of time, and then preparing for the Health Select Committee that we had and attended last week. What I want to do between now and December is actually spend some time going out and meeting staff within CQC. I attended the whole London staff event yesterday and spoke to them, and I hope to get those opportunities to meet. I'd like to meet all staff in the organisation before December, if that was physically possible to do that at those various settings. And in a sense, the question I'm asking is, what is it that I need to understand about CQC? What is it that has worked? What is it that we need to work on? And what's your advice to me as your incoming Chief Executive? And asking exactly the same question to key stakeholders. So what I've tried to do is set that out in that introductory paragraph so that we can contribute and continue to drive a culture which is about openness and accessibility. I need to strike a balance between listening and doing. Clearly there are some things that we need to get on with. I need to build the strategic capacity of the organisation, and we've got a replacement director to make around informatics, and scoping what those jobs are and how to take those forward is something I'd want to do over the next few weeks. And actually creating alignments with our strategic partners. What does that mean? How are we going to work with Monitor? How are we going to work with the commissioning board? How are we going to work with the professional regulators? So a sequence of meetings building on the work that has already gone on in that respect. And then critically, how do we develop relationships with departments like communities and local government more generally in light of local Health Watch, but the overview and scrutiny function that continues, and Health and Wellbeing Board functions, all of which are likely to generate information and intelligence which will be helpful to us in terms of our responsibilities, prioritising inspection and drawing on that local intelligence. I think local links colleagues in the audience that will probably resonate. So I hope what I've done there, Chair, is just set out some sense of ambition for how I'll spend my time over the next period, and just try and explain what I'll be doing and why. So these questions about, well, what's he doing? I hope I've begun to set that out, and then people have got a sense of it. Slightly more pragmatically, the rest of the report goes on and provides you with an update on primary medical services registration. It gives you a sense of the progress which is being made. About 7,500, about 90% of general practice had registered, notified us, we're chasing down those that haven't registered, that 10%, about 500 we think it is, and contact is being made with those to make sure that they're aware of the system and coming forward. As of, I think, last Friday, there were about 100 that had registered, and that number's going up each day. Progress is good. I'm sure Amanda would say that this is probably as great a take-up of new registrants of any registration we've opened. I have to say, coming in, Chair, that the advantage that the delay of registration of GPs to April 13 has given, it's allowed the organisation to put in place some impressive plans, and that time has been used well and constructively to make sure that this is planned well. We've also tested the inspection regime, and I've had feedback from that. So that design post-registration of the inspection regime is developing, and I'm going to do what I'm referring to as a deep dive with the programme board and other interested parties, so we can just dive into the middle of where we are and just check that these questions, well, what if everybody doesn't come forward? What are we going to do? We can get answers to those, and give you some reassurance as a board that those what if questions are being raised and we're providing answers to those. But that's work that's in process. I think the other thing, just to draw out without spending too long on this, Chair, is the significance of the work that has been done on primary care registration is we've created a digital platform for the first time for registration. Going back to what Martin was saying earlier, I suspect there's no regulator in the world that has actually got to new registrants, and I don't think we should snatch a defeat from the jaws of what is quite an innovative victory in the way that this is being taken forward. So something quite important, I think, to be proud of and pleased about, whilst acknowledging that this is something that really needs to be tested. Next section in the report is really an update of thematic reviews and an update of where we are. You know that thematic reviews are important, and there's been work going on in relation to how those thematic reviews inform things like the state of care report, the market report, etc. And thematic reviews are important. Colleagues have done some work through the Regulatory Risk Committee, chaired by Philip, in relation to what some further thematic reviews might be. And we're bringing forward three propositions for the board this afternoon, that we do some work on dementia care, something on people waiting for treatment, and then finally something on the physical health needs of people with learning disabilities. And we've talked about the outcome of these thematic reviews is it leads to improvement across the service by people taking account of the reports and then beginning to take action in the way that they run their services and organisations. We want to bring forward, not at this meeting, but at a later meeting, a fourth thematic review. We think those three are largely NHS focusing, arguably with dementia having a dual focus. But I think this list is probably missing something around adult social care, so we'd like to bring forward some further thoughts at a later date. So this isn't the complete programme, and Philip and colleagues are working on that. Next item is really about where we are on our strategy. This was launched on the 9th of September. We did this using video as well as the launch of the documents as well. We really did major on this at the select committee it is to be my only speech between now and December. I'm not going to talk about anything else but our strategic review, whether that's to our staff or stakeholders. And I think what we want to do on this is invite people into a conversation about what our purpose is. It is for consultation. We'll then revise that in January. I'd like to get it published back out in January. And then we'll set some time delivering that through our operational plan. One of the things that I'm emphasising, don't know whether colleagues heard Sebastian Kaur, as he gave evidence to the Culture, Media and Sports Select Committee, said the Olympics took him 2 years to bid, 7 years to plan and 7 weeks to deliver. And I think that's a really interesting lead-in to how long it takes to do something properly for success. And we won't take 7 years, I promise you. But actually, we do need to use this period between now and Christmas to consult on the strategy, where we don't go into delivery mode, we go into discussion mode about what is there, so we can plan what the next stages are and not rush into action. Often action is an excuse for not thinking, and I want us to think about what it is that we need to do before we go, and that's out for consultation. Deirdre has already referred in her report to the external investigations. There were some outstanding questions in relation to the robustness of the work that had been done on Morecambe Bay by the organisation. And in discussion with yourself, Chair, we felt it was important to commission some independent review of the actions in relation to Morecambe Bay. So what this paragraph is doing is just identifying that we've now let a contractor, Grant Thornton. They've begun that work testing the robustness of the actions in Morecambe Bay. The purpose of this is to get an independent view in relation to that. That will need, as you said, Deirdre, to sit alongside the report that is commissioned from Deloitte's, and then the work that Martin is leading with Philip, which is that bigger academic piece of work. So we've had a very hard forensic technical audit of our actions in Morecambe Bay. That then feeds into a much more regulatory focused review of our methodologies that sits alongside that more academic piece of work. So we've got a really gritty, granular forensic investigation, a thoughtful audit piece of work, and then an academic piece of work drawing on that knowledge. And that's what we assembled. They're the three phases, and we draw those together to tell us about the robustness of our systems and whether there's and what scope there is for the further development of our methodologies. And then finally, Chair, you've already referred to the Select Committee, and in the remainder of this brief note, we've just set out some of the key issues that were raised with us by members of the Select Committee. We have committed to providing them with some further information, and that work is to hand. And of course, we anticipate when their report comes out, they'll be looking for some further response from us. I think, as I've already indicated, one of the things that the committee did allow us to do is actually account for the history, but also to look forward and set out our ambitions for how the organisation's developing. And I hope some of those messages got landed as we went through. Some of the issues we were asked about are bigger issues, and we are responsible for fit and proper persons test, for instance, is an issue that would require policy and potentially a regulatory response, or even a legal response, and so that doesn't rest with us, but it signals an area for debate. If I leave it there, Chair, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much indeed, David. I'm sure colleagues will have questions. That was extremely helpful. Could I just seek clarification on topics for thematic review? Are you asking the board this afternoon to confirm that those three areas should be progressed and that you'll come back to us with a firmer proposition for adult social care?
I am, Chair. I think these thematic reviews are where the Commission finds its national and strategic voice. My view is that's a matter for the board to agree, so I think it's for the executive to propose to the board that these are the things you want to exercise your voice on and drive improvements on a national basis. I think the work that Philip has done on this is very good. I would recommend that you accept these as your national voice, but I think we need to come back to you with a fourth one on adult social care, because I think there will be an asymmetry in your voice if it just spoke to the NHS.
That's very helpful. Questions, comments from colleagues?
Yes, I was going to go straight to the thematic reviews. I think these are the important ones. I was going to ask if the second one, the experience of people waiting for NHS treatment, will include the appointment system. Because, first of all, I think all of the delays seem to me, I can remember something slightly more than anecdotal evidence, but I can't cite it chapter and verse, that the delays in being seen in the NHS are one of the biggest contributors to the poor rates of recovery of serious diseases in the UK. I know that was certainly the case when the NHS did a big project on cancer. And certainly there is something about appointments, and I know one shouldn't get too detailed in this, but I will just give this one story. My wife went to her GP and asked to get them to explain their appointment system, and they couldn't. So she said, could you write it out for her and send it to me? And 4 weeks later they said, we still can't explain it to you. And I don't think that's unusual. There is, you know, and we all remember Tony Blair being questioned in a couple of general elections ago. How can I get an appointment? You know, and it is a real problem. And I'm not saying we should say this is the way you do it, but if this is a barrier to people seeing doctors, it is going to be is going to contribute to health inequalities in the UK.
Perhaps, Philip, could you respond directly?
Yes, I can confirm we will be looking at that. As you say, it's not just the mere fact of the appointment and the delay, it's what that means for people's experience, so absolutely.
Steve, can I just add, still on the thematic reviews, if that's okay. I mean, I was also going to ask about this. I mean, because actually, although I don't disagree with all of these, I think it would be helpful for the board in making a decision to know what were the other topics that came up, so that we would be in a position to prioritise them. So when you come back with more detail, could I just ask you just to say what were the other themes and why did you choose these three? And because there could be something that's even more important in the board's opinion.
Be very happy to provide that information.
So I was just going to add that I attended the Health Select Committee, sitting quietly at the back, and I wanted just to pass on my views that certainly the criticisms I heard from the members of Parliament, members of the committee, were all the ones that we'd all heard before about things that they'd experienced, and all the positive stuff was about new things that one of them been to Newcastle, other talked about whistleblowers in their constituency and the follows up, and I thought the tide was turning in their response to the CQC, and I think both David and Joe did a splendid job.
When you're sort of out and about talking to staff, I would just like to, I'm sure you'll do this, but make a plea that you make attempts to speak to sort of Mental Health Act commissioners and second opinion appointed doctors, because I think there's still a sense that they don't feel part of the organisation, which I think you know about, but I think that to make very specific attempts to go and talk to as many as possible would be a very good thing to do. And if you have time, also speaking to experts by experience, because I think they could give you a very good sort of insight into what they do, because they're out doing inspections from a sort of user perspective. On the strategic review, I mean, it might be worth considering whether board, you know, subject to availability and time, whether board members could add some value to any aspect of that. Obviously, from my own perspective, I'm thinking in terms of mental health, but you know, it may be something to consider. And yeah, and just on the thematic reviews, I think it's what other people have said. It would be useful to understand the sort of rationale for the three that are proposed, and then the process that's gone through.
Do you just want to respond quickly?
So I will go to Nottingham. I will speak to the Mental Health Act Commissioners. I'm speaking to Simon Armisen in a couple of weeks' time. He wrote to me and I'll follow that up. There was a fantastic presentation last night on this work from members of staff that have been working on it, and to build on that, I will speak to experts by experience and some other groups, not just experts by experience. So I do want to speak to the Richmond group, for instance, who, as you probably know, Kate, a number of the mental health charities are actually involved in the Richmond group. So we do need to speak to those. On the selection of thematic reviews, my vision for this, Chair, will be that actually we bring you a list and ask you to select the topics from the list, not we bring you a list and say this is what we're going to do. So if you just bear with us on this is what we're going to do, because actually they need to start now, in future we'll bring you the wider list and with absolutely that analytic golden thread of why we think these are the issues to look at. And then you can make that selection, and we'll try and do that on the adult social care one. So if it's acceptable, Chair, to you and the board, if we go with these, and then in the future we'll bring you that longer list to select from, because I do want to emphasise this point. The strategic voice of CQC comes through the board considering these things, and the annual report, the state of care report, and these thematic reviews is where your voice goes national. These are the biggest things we do in our annual cycle, and therefore we need to make our voice heard on these. So we need to select them strategically and importantly with care.
Thank you, David. That's very helpful. I think, in truth, some time ago we did look at a long list as a board, and so I think you got something of a steer from the board, and possibly the shaping's been done since you had that steer, but we absolutely support the approach you're taking, David, that it should be a decision that rests here in this arena. Excuse me. So I just want to be clear, we as a board are now approving those three. Sorry, John, you've got a question or a comment?
Yes, could I just ask a question. I think strongly support the second of those three proposals for study, the experience of people waiting for NHS treatment. But I'd like to be clear about the boundaries of the study, and in particular something that we've talked about here in the board on a number of occasions previously, which is not just the absolute waiting list, not just the problems of access, but particularly with with complex NHS treatments, the requirement not just for the treatment, but also for diagnostic processes and tests and so on. And one of the sets of problems that regularly comes to my attention is the difficulty of navigating through the whole process, which extends the time to get through. So although a patient is in the system, and they may have taken so much time to get to that point of being in the system, they then take, in some places, significantly longer to get through the system than they do in other places. And I would like to be satisfied or to be reassured that this study is going to consider, on a sort of compare and contrast, why is it that some hospitals are able to do this much more expeditiously and apparently efficiently than others, because it does actually have a big impact on overall treatment time, on effective efficacy of treatment, and patient satisfaction.
Could I suggest then, in the light of that, David or yourself, Philip, circulate board members with the scope of those thematic reviews? I think that would be enormously helpful. Actually, I'm sure we'll put it on the website, because it should be in the public domain as well. I think that would
absolutely
be extremely,
yes,
helpful.
I'm sure that happens.
Okay, well, in that case, I think you're getting approval for those three thematic reviews, which I assume will commence in the fairly immediate future. I'm getting a nod, and presumably will run.
It'll be completed before the end of the financial year.
Excellent. Okay, that's very good. Okay, well, David, in conclusion then, I'd like to, on behalf of the board, thank you for your report. I think it was a very good first report, and from my own point of view, I think we'll keep you.
The next one.
Right. Let's move on to item eight, which is a report about CQC becoming a unitary board. Again, it's a decision paper. And I think that Louise, you might want to say something about it, but clearly David as chief executive might wish to as well. So I'll hand to you, Louise.
Thank you, Chair. Board members will recall that there has been some discussion ongoing with the Department of Health with regard to how we could achieve within CQC a unitary board. That was part of the Department of Health Performance and Capability Review recommendations, and it was something that the board had discussed previously in any event. Regulatory changes were made, or a small change to specific membership regulations were made by the Department of Health to enable us to move to a unitary board. In July, you discussed how you might want to do that and the possible membership of a unitary board. And David, who was fresh in at that time, expressed a wish to mull it over, to think very carefully about what would be the best approach and the options for that. And this paper sets out the recommendation that David has made with regard to the fact that he feels that the Chief Executive Officer should be a member of the board. And in the paper, and specifically on page 3 of 4, at paragraph 2, there is set out there reasons why it is felt that that would be the most appropriate move forward, to do with size and the balance, getting the balance right between non-executive members and executive members, and the complexity, I think, around that. And I'm sure David will have something to say, but he also felt that as chief executive, he could reflect the views of and the work of the executive team in his role. So as a result of that, obviously that issue is here for approval by the board today, but as a result of that, we thought we had to think about the role description for board members, and this is at 2.6 in the paper. The amended draft role description is appended to this paper for your approval, and effectively it is just reflecting the fact that we have a unitary board, and it's putting all either non-executive or executive members of the board on an equal footing. As I say, the detail of that is at 2.6. There is a further document attached to, a draft document attached to this paper, which I also seek your approval today on, and that's the vision for corporate governance in CQC. Now, this is part of the overall corporate governance framework project work, and it is a high-level vision, that's what it says on the tin, with regard to how you as the board and we as the organisation wish to take forward corporate governance within this organisation. So it's a forward look, it's our ambition and how we want to improve corporate governance. So that's the third document that is attached here. My request to you would be for approval of all three, so the suggestion of the Chief Executive Officer being on the board, approval of the new role description, and then comments possibly, and approval of the vision for corporate governance.
Thank you, that's very clear. Three decisions for us to make. I've got Martin indicating.
So thank you very much for this paper. I think the approach that's been recommended is very sensible at the current time, so I certainly approve it. My only comment is in Annex A, on the first page, one of the bullet points in the centre in reference to the specific responsibilities of all board members, one of them relates to the appointment of the new chief executive. And I don't think it's appropriate that an outgoing chief executive is responsible for the appointment of a new chief executive. So I'd assume that David would remove himself at some stage in 20 years' time, would remove himself from that particular item.
Martin, it's your point. that we should make that absolutely explicit. I think if that's your point, I agree with that.
I think it's good practice.
I agree. Yeah, thank you. That's a good amendment.
Yes, I approve that the chief exec is a member of the board, and that I'm very happy with that, and I agree with Martin's point. On the role of board members, on the second page, I'm concerned that one of the essential criteria has been removed, which is having experience, particular experience of the issues faced by service users. Obviously, that was an essential criteria when I was appointed, so I'd like to request that that's put back in, please. And also on the thing about the sort of corporate governance, I mean, I don't expect a response now, and I'm sure that we're going to be doing some work on that, but I think it would be useful to consider how as a board, when board members are raising serious concerns, that we're quite clear about what the process is for that. And I know that there's a plan to do that, but I think it's a really important thing for us to, do. And so there's absolute clarity on that.
Okay, any further comments? Well, let me just say a couple of things. I am in looking at the essential criteria. I too noted, Kay, that we hadn't got the user perspective there, and I think we should amend appropriately. I agree with that. The issue relating to board members raising concerns is absolutely right, and it may well be that there are a number of discussions to be had across arm's length bodies about this matter, so it's something that we will look at internally, but I think we should contribute to on a wider canvas. So I don't know whether any further questions or comments. So let me be clear then, we are approving the recommendation that the chief executive of CQC becomes a member of the board. We're approving the revised member role description, making it absolutely clear that the a chief executive, the outgoing chief executive, would not be involved in the appointment of a new one, and that we would include under essential criteria user perspective. And finally, I think, Kay, if I'm understanding you, well, let me just check, are we agreed that we will approve that subject to that amendment?
Approving the revised
rules? Yes, yes, are we approving that?
We're including user perspective.
Yes.
Yeah, where?
Sorry, it's on the essential criteria.
Yeah, but there are several places where it could be included.
Essential criteria.
So it becomes a new, if you're saying a new bullet point.
Yes.
So someone who doesn't have user experience is not eligible to sit on.
No, it's one or more.
Yeah. Right, okay. More. So it's in that first bullet point.
Yes.
Just to be absolutely clear about this, the paper, the heading is essential criteria for board members, yes. Senior level experience and experience in one or more of the following areas. So we add it as
into
an
that
area.
Section.
Yes. Right. Yes. So on that basis,
apologies for coming in. So just in terms of the decision you're going to make in relation to the unitary board, at 2.4 in the report, Louise has said that we need to make sure that CQC is not an outlier in terms of the governance arrangements, and at the minute we are. So I think the process, Louise, I think, is that now that you've made a decision about a unitary board, it will be for you, Chair, to write to the Secretary of State and ask for his decision that that's what happens. And I think it's important we include in that letter in the first instance, or words to that effect, which actually also lands this point that we actually want our governance reconciling with every other arm's length body in the way that board level appointments are made. And that seems to be an important point, which is flagged up. That's what the last sentence in 2.4 means of Louise's report.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're clear about that. We've got approval for Chief Executive to become a member. We will seek approval from the Secretary of State. The second thing we've done is approve the revised member role description subject to amendment with user perspective. And then are we able to approve the corporate governance vision? And the point I was going to make is that in doing that, we also note that we need to do an additional piece of work in relation to how board members raise matters of concern. Is that satisfactory?
Could I just comment, Chair? I mean, I thought maybe Alistair could remind me, but I think we did have code of practice for board members. Is that not covered under that?
We do have the code of practice, and we also have the policy which refers to how to raise concerns internally, and the scope of that is intended to apply, and it states that it does, both to members of staff, but also the non-executive, and that this was revised recently. It came to the board to update it in a number of facets, and it included that. But if we wanted to take that and make that more explicit in the code of practice for board members, we could easily do so, I think, without cutting across that.
Yeah, it's just, I thought I remember we discussed it recently.
Thank you for that. Let's move on to item 9, which is our quarterly performance report. This is contains information from April to June. This is an information paper, but it provides board members with the opportunity to scrutinise performance and to ask questions of the executive. So I'll take questions, please.
Chair, thank you very much. I have already informally given notice to executive colleagues of a few questions I wanted to ask, and they are, first of all, on page 4 of the paper. I see that our performance against the target for inspections in independent healthcare and ambulance services, and to a certain extent in dentists, is falling well behind our plan. And I'd like to understand whether that ground can be recovered, or whether the situation is such that we are going to end the year underperforming in those areas. And I'd also like Amanda, if possible, to, on the following page, page 5, just to explain to us how the information on whistleblowing contact is going to be enhanced in the future. And then after that, I'd like to come back with a couple of other points which are more to do with policy.
I'm just wondering, perhaps we could take some more comments from Commissioners. Deirdre.
Thank you very much. I'm concerned with two issues. I'm just looking for the pages now. I think it's page 6 of 10, looking at the underspend on staff costs. So it's pages 6 and 7, looking at the underspend on staff costs, and I'd like some more explanation on the plans to recruit staff so that we don't end up with an under capacity of inspectors to complete the work. So that's one. Is there a plan to ensure that? I know it takes a long time for recruitment, so there may just be a time lag, so I'd like some further information on that. And with regard to, apologies, I'm going to have to find this now, it's a different colour. With relation to the report on inspections and compliance, Amanda and Philip, we did discuss in the audit and risk. I didn't raise it under my report, but we would be expecting to receive at the Audit and Risk Assurance an analysis of that, and whether we would be able in the future to include that analysis in the performance report. Those two points.
Also a point of detail on page four in relation to the production of draft reports and final reports, and a note is made of the delays. This should matter a lot to providers. It certainly matters a lot in terms of their perceptions of our efficiency as an organisation. So I'm just wondering what the causes of the delays are. In particular, if it is about negotiation with the provider, I recognise that takes time. Do we need to be changing our targets?
Yeah, page seven, it's to do with the website. When I read this, I don't really have an understanding of how we're performing, really, in the sense that, we really need to understand if people are using the website and that they find it useful and helpful, because it can be quite difficult to find information. Because I noticed, for example, that over half just go to the homepage. Does that mean they don't go anywhere else? And does it mean they're put off by the homepage? I mean, I don't know. So it's just a bit of context on, what's actually happening with the website and any sort of plans in terms of developing it and evaluating it, please. Thanks.
Focused on process matters, and while that is all important, I think what we as a board are looking for is what added value CQC provides to the services that come from providers, and whether they are improving. And I think that's a moving target, so inevitably things will have to change. But I do think it's important that we get ahead of the curve and start developing a set of indicators that will provide answers to those questions, because they're not easy to come up with. And if we just think about it and say, oh, we'll do that in a year's time, and we'll be struggling for a year after that. So I think it's work that needs to be started now so that we can start measuring whether services are improving, which I think is part of our brief.
Very much. Now, we got seven questions there. Amanda, could you deal with the operational issues, please? And then I'll ask Alison to deal with the HR issues. And Jill, if you would pick up on the website, and then possibly, I don't know whether Mark, you could say something about impact and changing the indicators. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. If I start with the first question on independent healthcare and ambulance performance, we've looked at this very carefully across each of the four regions, and it's no surprise that we are below trajectory, certainly on independent healthcare. The board will recall that in the January to March performance, we undertook the cosmetic surgery inspections and the termination of pregnancy clinics. So in the absence of risk from other independent healthcare organisations, they would be later in the schedule of inspections this year. Each region has been asked to profile in to achieve our public commitments and performance on each of these sectors. And we have asked the regions, which will be available from Friday, for discussion with David and the executive team for any or timelines when we will be completing. We're anticipating completing our programme in each sector, and any shortfall on the basis of increased responsive inspections that take up our capacity, or any shortfall in inspectors joining the organisation. So a very robust piece of basing of our activity and trajectories has been produced by region. So to give confidence to the board, clearly we are looking at this very carefully, and it's our intention to deliver on our activity.
Okay, and just to be clear, if there is any difficulty or having done the analysis, you reach a conclusion that there will be some slippage, that will be reported to the board at the next meeting. Thank you.
Absolutely. If I move on to the other performance questions, draft and final reports, again, we have done some analysis. We can now report at regional level on achievements against both of these indicators. There is variance across the regions, and the deputy directors are following that through with their teams as to whether it is something in the way that they are scheduling their inspection activities, so doing the inspections and then leaving longer to write the reports, and whether there is something that we need to build in a more consistent process for doing the inspection and writing the report. We should be seeing an improved performance overall, reporting through from this month with the improved template and the CRM improvements that went live at the beginning of September. And there is a small proportion of delays that are a consequence of representations, but that isn't the primary factor in performance on draft and final reports. On the whistleblowing question, the board will be aware from the really helpful presentation yesterday evening that not only have we introduced the track and chase, as Tracy described it, so we are following through on every whistleblowing contact until it is a decision is made to close that contact by the frontline inspection teams, but we have also commissioned a piece of audit activity that will track through a case tracking on a sample of whistleblowing to identify how we can better understand the impact of whistleblowing information, how much whistleblowing information translates or converts into enforcement activity. Is whistleblowing information, does that get you to risk quicker than a scheduled inspection, for example? And we're also undertaking a piece of quality assurance with our internal audit around, again, assuring on our processes and the impact of the decisions that we make as a result of whistleblowing process. We would anticipate bringing an initial report back to the November board on that activity. And the analysis and addition of the strategic risk and regulatory risk information into the corporate scorecard. Again, as we are developing and refining our reporting mechanisms, it would absolutely make sense that what goes to ARAC in terms of, again, the impact and understanding the decisions and the activity over and above raw data, that it is reported through in terms of corporate activity, so it isn't just numbers.
Thank you. What I can say, Professor Kelly, is in answer to your question, is that as of today, we have 59 compliance inspector vacancies. So we've moved quite a long way in the last month or so. There has been, it's safe to say, some regions that have been more difficult to recruit to than others. So London being the main example there. So what we did in the last campaign is we altered our tack in some respects. We went out to radio, for example, so that people knew about the vacancies that we had. So of those 59 vacancies, we've gone through, the closing date was at the end of August. We've gone through, we had over 3,000 applications, and we've shortlisted nearly 2,000 to go through our portal, which is the next phase of the application process. We anticipate interviewing round about 500. That might seem like a large number, but what we're trying to build is a hot list whereby we will always have a stream of people that have been through the recruitment process and been approved to recruit, so that as and when people leave the organisation, we can immediately pick up the phone and offer someone a post. And there was an example of that last week, that within 2 hours of receiving a compliance inspector resignation, we'd actually made an offer. So that's how the process ought to work going forward. It's taken us some time getting there, but we didn't want to compromise on quality at the same time.
Yes, thank you, Kay. Your question prompted me to think that actually I had not updated the board on the fact that we had a whole new release on our website last week called Provider Profile 2, where we updated many, many features on it. So I think what I can perhaps do is, rather than answer a piecemeal question here, is to provide you with an update on, one, all the changes that we've just made last week, and secondly, to advise you where we are in terms of monitoring feedback on our website and how we respond to questions, because in fact we do get, when members of the public email and say, I can't find X or Y, my team do take that seriously and think about how they can address it. So I'm very happy to provide the board with an overall update. So we have done a lot of work on it.
Yes, thank you. In terms of the quality measures, there's a number of things that we're doing linked into, at one end, the work that's going on the evaluation piece that has been mentioned earlier. And at the other end, a lot of the kind of indicators that we try to put in place and strengthen through this report. And the piece in the middle for me is more around those quality kind of measures. And we have the project going on, which makes sure that at every level of the organisation, we're looking to improve those measures. So we're starting to put some of those quality indicators in. And actually at the back of this particular report, where there's some charts around sort of changes in compliance, it's early days, but it's starting to try and tease out some of those more qualitative indicators, and we're continuing to work on that. So. I think over the last year we've come a long way with this report. We know we've still got a long way to go, but we're focusing more on those quality measures, and we're starting to see those coming through as they develop, because they're not easy to deliver and to capture the kind of information we want to give that sort of rounded picture. But it's very much part of the project that we're doing and linking in with Philip on the evaluation side.
Okay. Thank you. Deirdre, you want to come back?
Just got one query, and maybe I've missed it. I'm sorry, but in the whistleblowing data, it would be really interesting to know how many of them are upheld. I mean, we talked a lot about the track and chase and making sure they weren't dropped until it was fine. But it'd be really interesting to know how many are upheld and were not malicious or were dismissed, because I think that's an important bit, because it looks like a huge number of whistleblowing, but. I think in terms of understanding the quality of that whistleblowing and what happens, you may not have that now, but for me that's a really important aspect. When I went to Newcastle, I did ask them, you know, what was the number that actually turned out to be genuine.
I think an audit has been conducted, and we've got some data. I haven't got it to hand, but...
Can you do this, Amanda? So.
Yes, there's two... challenges that you pose here. The first is the qualitative, so what difference does it make, and does whistleblowing actually inform risk and how quickly we follow through? So that will form part of the audit that we are now doing, the case tracking that we are now doing. But the Chair's quite right, we did undertake a sample audit on 40 whistleblowing earlier this year, and that translated to approximately 25%, leading to some level of enforcement action. Another piece of work that we're going to be doing with internal audit colleagues that David, as the incoming Chief Executive, is keen to see us explore, is being very clear in our definitions and therefore our processes around what do we mean by safeguarding, what do we mean by complaints, what do we mean by whistleblowing, and being much clearer with the public about what we do with that information, so that we have got very transparent expectations of what CQC can do with that information that's given to us.
David, you were going to come back on the money.
Deirdre asked about variance on the budget as well, and it relates to Alison's answer in terms of where we are on staffing. So I think John Lappin would have reported this if it had been here. So I think on page 6 of 10 of the report that you've got on performance, the top table there talks at the variance to date, and that's showing £3.3 million variance. That's an underspend in relation to it. Paragraphs below show where that is attributed to staff costs. That's a £1.8 million variance. You can see it also relates to non-staff costs. There's some technical adjustments for depreciation. And I've never said this before, there's an over-recovery of income. In my professional life, I've never said that before. So there is an over-recovery of income. And so that's how you get to the 3.3. The key issue, I think, is what are we projecting towards the year end? As Alison said, there's appointments in the pipeline. There's been an acceleration in the way that can be done. And I think the example that Alison shared with you is indicative of that. So when I asked John prior to the Health Select Committee what we thought the final outturn would be and the variance on that, he was actually reflective, and this is a guesstimate, but between 6 and 7 million. I think the important thing for us to hold on to and the opportunity that you present by your question, Deirdre, is that when we are fully staffed to the establishment of the additional 250 plus inspectors that came forward at the 153 million, we will use all of that 153 million. So the issue is that we've taken time to build up the staffing. It is absolutely right, as Alison said, we don't make decisions based on numbers, we make decisions based on quality. So, but for a full financial year 13 to 14, if we're given 153 million to move forward with, and we were fully staffed, notwithstanding the attrition that would take place, retirements, resignations, etc., we'll use that money. So we're not carrying surplus when we're running to establishment, I think is the way that John had explained it.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I think John Harwood's got some further questions.
Yes, Chair, thank you, I do indeed, although I'm fascinated by the term over-recovery of income, which that's what I'll talk about later on. I said right at the beginning that I wanted to make a few points about what seemed to me to have policy implications. And first of all, I just want to say thank you to Mark and his team for the improvements which are taking place in the quality of data that we're now beginning to receive. It's not yet perfect. It doesn't explore some of the areas that, for example, Steve was talking about to the extent that we would like, but I think it is, well, it's only fair to say, I think it is a significant improvement. And I know a lot of work has gone in to achieve that, so I just want to record that. And the reason that I've always said that this sort of data is so important is because it enables us to understand what is happening and to highlight policy issues to do with how we go about the work of being a regulator. And it is on two of those that I want to raise particular questions. The first, and these all relate to the pack of appendices at the back. And the first is on chart number 12, which tells us the number of locations in each sector that meet essential standards of quality and safety. And what this shows is that there's quite a high proportion of inspections which yield non-compliance of one type or another, but also a very large proportion of the territory that we regulate has not yet been inspected. And the latest data we have is that over 23,000 locations had not yet been subject to review, which is a very considerable proportion of the territory. Now, I'm not saying that that is automatically wrong. What I'm saying is I think that it would be helpful for us, certainly me, to be reassured that the management was confident that the areas which had not yet been inspected were low risk, and therefore resources were being concentrated onto the high risk. Because this isn't this isn't the providers, this is the locations. And providers are different categories. Different types will have a variety of numbers of locations. But I, for one, would like to be reassured, for example, that if we have a provider that we know has problems with non-compliance, and we know that there are other locations providing the same service in that provider's portfolio, that we don't not go and look at those other locations simply because they're not on our list. In other words, that inspection is triggered by the performance of that same provider in the same service in other locations. So that's, and I'm not asking for an answer now, I'm asking David, Amanda, whoever, to take away these questions and come back to us with some answers to the how is it done and how can we be assured that is being done effectively. And the second area of my question applies to the following page, page 13, which shows this doesn't appear on the bar chart, this only appears in the table, but what it shows is that the number of NHS locations which have been non-compliant for over a year has doubled since from the last quarter of the last financial year to the first end of the first quarter of this financial year. That is in itself a concerning issue, and as of course to me, any provider that remains non-compliant for more than a year does seem to me to be a matter of concern. And I would like advice from the executive, again, not now, but how and in what way we're going to keep closer observation surveillance on these providers and be satisfied that they are taking the appropriate steps to return to compliance for the benefit of the people who, the patients who are in those particular organisations. So they are requests for further work. I appreciate that management information systems always generate requests for further work, which is I've tried to be modest about what I'm expecting.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. And I think if I could ask you to switch your mic off, thank you. If I could ask David and the executive to take those questions away and report back to the board, that would be enormously helpful. Thank you very much indeed. Any further questions or comments? Okay, in that case, we'll receive that report and move on to the next item, item 10, which is the strategic risk paper. I'm looking at Louise to take us through that, please.
Thank you, Chair. It's back to me. Professor Kelly, in her brief update earlier, has already referred to the work that's ongoing in relation to the strategic risk register and the rationale for having this paper, which is a background to the refreshed work that is taking place within the organisation, as well as the existing strategic risk register, is that we can keep, you can keep an eye on our strategic risks as they stand, but that you are assured that there is work taking place now to refresh those strategic risks and also ongoing work given the consultation on the strategy that is ongoing at the moment. So this is something that will need to be continuously refreshed. Very, very briefly, Chair, the paper sets out the progress that has been made on the refreshing work, specifically the two workshops that have been held with board members involved, independent members of the Audit and Risk Assurance Committee, and other officers who are involved in assessing risk and dealing with risk. And they have been very productive, and the third workshop is due to take place on the 17th of October. That's just a little brief for you on page 3 of 4 in the report with regard to what the early findings are in relation to that, and the fact that there will be further work to develop the refreshed strategic risk register on the 17th of October and moving on from that. So that's what's happening in relation to the future, the near future, and the strategic risk register, which is also provided to you today. You'll recognise it's the present strategic risk register in the present form that we are using with an update in relation to the evaluation of the ongoing mitigations.
Thank you, Louise. Are there any questions, please, from members of the board? Okay. Well, in that case, let's note this report, but also note the progress that's being made, and we will be attending the workshop on the 17th of October. Thank you. So that takes us on to item 11, which is an update on safeguarding. An update on safeguarding. Again, this is not a decision paper. It's a report that we're asked to note. However, Also to be aware that the serious case review in relation to Winterbourne View has now been published, and there were recommendations made which seemed eminently sensible in the context of the work that we're doing in relation to ongoing monitoring of learning disability services. And what this report is doing is really pulling together an action plan relating to safeguarding, which I think the executive are hoping that the board will agree. So I'm going to ask Amanda Sherlock to take us through that report, please.
Thank you, Chair. And if I start by saying that Bill Hodgson, one of our national professional advisors who chairs our safeguarding committee, very much wanted to be here today to discuss with the board some of the issues that are raised through the various pieces of safeguarding activity. Unfortunately, well, fortunately for him, he's on holiday. Unfortunately for the board, I will try to do justice to his very, very eminent chairing of our safeguarding activity. As you've just mentioned, Chair, we saw the publication of the serious case review into the events at Winterbourne View at the beginning of August. We worked very proactively and were very committed to working through the entire process of the serious case review in order to develop ourselves as an organisation, but also contribute to national policy. And that national policy development will continue through the autumn, not least in the care and welfare work that the Department of Health are taking forward, care and welfare bill. The report covers a series of recommendations and updates on safeguarding. So as well as the serious case review, we had our own internal management review and committed to keep the board up to date with how we were progressing in meeting those recommendations. We've also had a very recent internal audit, and that will be reporting back to ARAC, I believe the next ARAC meeting, as well as our operational delivery plan and development plan around safeguarding. So the main focus of the paper is to seek the board's agreement in pulling all of those various strands together under the safeguarding subcommittee that will report into the regulatory risk committee and through to ARAC, so that we have got coherent oversight of this very, very important work. It can be tracked and monitored and quality assured within a consistent framework. And noting that the board may wish to provide us with a steer or their insights on the recommendations coming out of the Winterbourne View serious case review as to how they would like us to prioritise those, and to ask the board to note the annual report into safeguarding activity that is a factual commentary on the activities that we undertook in the last business year that we would be wanting to put going forward into the annual report as a commentary on a very, very important piece of our core activity as a regulator. Thank you, Chair.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Amanda. I just want to, if my voice will allow me, to say one or two, make one or two comments, particularly in relation to Winterbourne View serious case review and our own internal management review. The work that we undertook following the Panorama programme was to set up a steering group, including many people who, through their lives, either through work or personal experience, knew a great deal about learning disability. So we had a kind of steering group that have guided the work and been very challenging in the way in which we've proceeded. Interestingly, they have also contributed to the ongoing work led by the Department of Health by really challenging some public policies. And although our work specifically on the follow-up reviews has been concluded, members, a significant number of people from the initial steering group are very keen to continue to work together, to work with CQC, not to lose the momentum. And it's particularly true to say that experts by experience and family carers and the Challenging Behaviour Forum are quite determined that they, with our help and the help of other agencies, will do everything possible to really highlight some of the ways in which the new commissioning arrangements within the NHS should take account of what has been learned so far. So there's a lot of, there will be, continue to be, I think, significant pressure and lobbying to ensure that localised services are developed for people with a learning disability rather than being moved from their home. The second thing to say is that we have a group of experts by experience, both family carers and people themselves who've experienced service, who are very keen to continue to work with CQC. And I think they've built up a body of knowledge that we must tap into. And I think they have the potential, some of them, for engaging in the training and development programs of our workforce. They've got a huge contribution to make, and I think that would be absolutely invaluable. Perhaps the last thing to say is that CQC, I think, can play its part in raising issues about public policy, but actually we can't drive it. So it's really making the point that we need to make sure, and this is the very heart of your work, Amanda, that actually what we have learned we embed throughout the organisation. If we do that well, then we can contribute at a strategic level to the development of further changes in public policy. But that's the heart of what I think we have to take from both the serious case review and our own internal management review, that this is a high-risk area of work, and we have to embrace the messages and get them understood across the organisation. So, I mean, that was just by way of perhaps explaining a little bit of the way in which our work has been very successfully guided, I think, by the inclusion of those range of individuals at stakeholder level, but also by those who truly experience services. So, other comments from colleagues, please, and Martin and Deirdre.
Yes, thank you very much, Jo. I'd like to welcome this report. Well done. I think making good progress here. Really just a plea as far as the safeguarding annual report is concerned, and I think it builds on comments that both John and Steve made earlier about our expectations moving forward. I recognise that we're on a journey, but in this report, in the future, it'll be good to see more data, better data, and better analysis and interpretation of that data. At the moment, it's very high level and very descriptive. So let's keep on pushing on that journey.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to echo Martin's comments, a very important area, and one of the aspects that I'm not sure that it is as well covered as it could be is the fact that safeguarding is almost, safeguarding incidents and alerts are almost universal in many different organisations, particularly adult social care. And so, in a sense, the question for me is why is this, such a difficult issue? And, what does it say about the education and training of the staff in those organisations? This is very good about how we've looked at smartening up our act, which I'm very pleased about, and that's absolutely essential. But what are we doing to say to the rest of the world, what are you doing about smartening up your act? Because it shocked me when I first looked at the incidents from, looking at the detailed regulatory reports. Safeguarding comes up all the time. And whether it's adults or children, it's horrific. And why does it keep coming? It's not a new problem. It's not a new problem for the UK. and yet we're not getting any better at it nationally. And if we have a role somewhere, either through this report or something else, and just saying to other organisations, what are you doing about it? Here's a blueprint.
Okay, and perhaps, Jill, you might want to comment on that last point in relation to the State of Care report. Thank you.
I think we've done some really good work following the Winterbourne review situation, which is really good. Often what people will say is that we have these sort of high-profile scandals and reviews, and people say lots of good things and there's progress made, but the kind of issue is about sustaining it. And there's not it is a difficult thing because, you know, you think, oh, well, we've got that sorted and we move on to something else. I mean, that's very simplistic. But I do think having that body of people who are willing to work with us, who've used services and carers, who can be there to sort of, I guess, in the kind of critical friend role, I think that's a really good model. You know, I mean, we have to be realistic about what we can and can't do, not overpromise. But I think, you know, having that now expert body to, as our sort of conscience is a good thing and could help that. The other issue that I wanted to raise, it's aligned to it, but it's very important, is around the whistleblowing aspect. And we've talked a lot about what action we take when whistleblowers contact us. And I think we've done a lot around that, and that's good. But what I also know is that for whistleblowers, whether it's people who are working in the service or people who use the service, it's a really high-risk thing to do. And I think it will be useful for us as an organisation to think about what issues whistleblowers actually face, because it's, we are reliant to some extent on whistleblowers coming to us. And if people are scared or reluctant to do that because of potential consequences, now I'm not sure the parameters of what we can and can't do, but there is certainly momentum gathering that we need to think much more about what it means to whistleblow. And I think we should be part of that conversation because we are one of the designated bodies for whistleblowers. And I think in terms of, you know, encouraging people to come forward and making it as safe as possible, I think that we could have a leadership role and contribute to that debate. And as I say, the debate is getting louder, and I think that's a good thing. And you know, we could contribute to that. Yeah.
Would you like to pick up the point about safeguarding?
Certainly. If I think I've understood the point that you were making, Deirdre, was what are we doing around raising awareness about safeguarding and people's responsibility in relation to safeguarding, not just our own in terms of handling it. And I think the point is also connected to Kay's point about whistleblowing, and in fact David and I were talking about a language thing, which is one of the things with the word safeguarding is unless you work in the industry, you don't know what safeguarding means. So any more than whistleblowing, David said about speaking out. In some senses, they're rather loaded words, safeguarding, whistleblowing. And I think we have to think about how we get the language right and the engagement right so people are not frightened by the terminology, but feel free to express their concerns. And if I think about the work we've done with things like the Patients Association, most of the information they give to us will be safeguarding, almost all of it, because that's the sort of information that they get. We just don't call that safeguarding, and they probably don't call it safeguarding. So I've taken it away, both points, and thought, in the state of care, how do we possibly think about how we reference those cases, how we think more about awareness, and how we think about our language on our website, and when we're talking, engaging with the public, that we are encouraging open feedback around any situation, but not trying to categorise it into safeguarding or whistleblowing, which is often language that people don't really understand or indeed are put off by it, I think.
I think I also had a wider point, Jill, which is that let's say safeguarding in the old-fashioned terms, you know, physical abuse, for instance. If there is an increase in the incidences of physical abuse to the elderly, why is that so? I mean, we've had lots of national report. You know, it's pointing to something that isn't working in the in these organisations, and that really worries me. I mean, it really worries me that as a country, we are allowing this to happen to our young and old, or to others, and somehow or other, there's something wrong with the education or the training or the staff. Because it's systemic, isn't it? We get lots and lots of reports about it. And it may be not something we can do now, but it's something that concerns me. And I think, you know, if we aren't one of the people who raise it as an issue, who else is going to raise it as an issue?
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. I was interested in the GMC report that came out this week that said the number of complaints about GPs has gone up, but by the way, we don't think GPs have got worse, we just think the number of complaints have gone up. I suspect whistleblowing and safeguarding could be a bit like that, which is what's you said earlier, David, what's the right number for whistleblowing? What's the right number for safeguarding? But nevertheless, though, if we believe the incidences reported to us are going up, we should make a point about that.
So I think this is a fabulously important conversation, really, about clarity of definitions, and it plays to, I think, board members' desire to understand what the impact of these things is. And we will take that away and give some further thought on it. I'm incredibly struck by a reframing of the debate about whistleblowing to speaking out. And therefore there's a sense whereby if you don't put that label on, does that free people to say things? But it puts an onus on the organisation to listen in a different way. And there's something important in that, I think. But I think, Deirdre, to speak to your point, it may well be that the ending of this safeguarding annual report might contain an action which we would take at a senior level in CQC, perhaps even a board-to-board level, with a Health Education England in the future. So this point about what's the curricular content of professional training. So in a sense, we don't just leave this to float in the air. We don't try and boil the ocean, but we do say this is relevant intelligence to inform the work of others, just as we would want their intelligence to inform our work. And I think our ambition for the State of Care report and the annual report is instead of having, I think we've got four or five annual reports that we must make on different functions. So we could continue to segment those, or we could bring them together into one document, which I think would give a more powerful voice to the organisation. But on some of the things, the so what question for that is, having said what we've said about this, and this has been a perennial throughout my 30-odd year career, I have to say, this issue about the skills that people have got. But actually, I think we need to keep doing that and keep saying that. So my vision for some of this work will be, and this is what's implicit in the work we've been describing that we're carrying on, is perhaps we might raise those bigger issues, and perhaps one of the actions will be our board-to-board with Health Education England. I'm now presuming we're going to have one. This might be an agenda item that we would want to raise with them in the future. When we do the board-to-board with the professional regulators, again, this might be an issue that we want to raise with the professional regulators. Not setting yourself up with a long action plan for what inspectors will do, but how we give meaning to the intelligence we gather through our activity and then articulate that in a way that drives improvement in services. So we don't overpromise, but we use our intelligence to inform a debate about how improvement can take place.
That's really helpful. I think I was seeing a lot of nods around the room in relation to what you were saying, David. So I think that was getting a lot of support from the board. Specifically in relation to this paper, I think we should note, as we're asked to, the progress that's been made in relation to our internal management review. Note that I, on behalf of CQC, accepted the recommendations of the serious case review specific to CQC, and that we do want a unified action plan, bringing together those safeguarding recommendations. So I think if David, you and the team could take that forward, that would be most helpful. Okay, thank you. Now, Alison's pointed out to me we're ahead of time. However, I'm not going to allow you to have a tea break until 3:10 unless somebody says they need a break earlier. Is everyone comfortable with going for?
Keep going.
Yes, that's agreed by all. Okay. So item 12 is an annual report that we're asked to note on the enforcement activity under the Health and Social Care Act 2008. And this paper is going to be introduced by both Louise and Amanda.
Thank you, Chair, and I will take you through the paper, and if I miss anything important, then I'm sure Amanda will kindly pick me up on it. As has been mentioned, yes, this is an annual report on enforcement activity. This is something that the board has had in previous years. And just to mention, before I go into the report itself, David's comment just about taking these snapshots of activity, like the safeguarding, like enforcement, like the next one on the agenda, review of complaints annual report, that actually there our intention and our purpose moving forward is to have those in one report and to make the linkages between the individual aspects that we're reporting on. Right, that said, we have a report here for your for you to note and for your consideration. Enforcement activity under the Health and Social Care Act 2008. So the paper on page 3 in the background at paragraph 2.1 sets out that this is the first year that we're reporting enforcement activity with everything under the Health and Social Care Act. So previous reports, we've had to report split activity through the year under the previous, the Care Standards Act 2000, and then Health and Social Care Act, depending on the whether it's health or social care we're reporting on, what type of provider. So this is the first year that we can actually report consistently across all of those sectors under the same legislation, therefore under the same powers that the Act provides to us in terms of enforcement. So paragraph 2.2, I'm sure it would be more than tedious for me to take you through all of the enforcement powers that we have, and I'm sure you're aware of them already. A mix of criminal enforcement powers and civil enforcement powers. And at paragraph 2.3, a note just to remind you that we are now reporting in this operational year under a new enforcement policy and judgment framework. So all of the information that's reported here is under the old enforcement policy and judgment framework. On page 4 of the report, there's some detail in the table at 3.1 regarding the four quarters of the operational year and the enforcement activity that took place within those four quarters. You'll note that there is, across the four quarters, an increase in the service of warning notices. We're pretty consistent on the service of notices of proposal to cancel, and that is, I think we've seen that across a number of years. A limited number of prosecutions, although it was particularly complex. No penalty notices. We have made some use of caution in lieu of prosecution, and one suspension of registration. The last column, which is imposition or variation of removal of a condition, I think is an important one, because this is the area of enforcement activity where we as an organisation can remove a location from a provider's registration. So if they have, an example, 10 locations of care homes, one is failing, and the rest are doing very well, we don't cancel the registration for the provider, but what we will do is vary the conditions or remove a condition to remove that location to ensure that that location can no longer carry on. So what you can see there is a reasonably consistent set of numbers which would indicate that we've been taking action with regard to locations. There's some detail there at 3.2 with regard to the prosecution that took place, quite a lengthy matter that was appealed, and we were successful in relation to that, a provider that was carrying on a regulated activity without being registered to do so. At 3.4, the detail to underpin the table on the simple cautions. At 3.5 on page 5 of the report, some detail about the use of warning notices, and I know we've spoken before about the complexity of a warning notice not only being a civil enforcement tool in terms of the civil elements of registration and compliance with regulations, but also a precursor to any criminal action and the complication that that causes. I mention it there in the report. A little detail about the notices of proposal, and I think possibly at 3.6.2, the examples that Amanda's team have been able to provide for us to put into the report give a little bit of life, I think, to the use of our enforcement powers and where we have used our enforcement powers to good effect. There is some, I've provided some detail at paragraph 4, which is on page 6 of the report, with regard to what we see as limitations on the use of our enforcement powers, and have confirmed that we continue to work with the Department of Health, or put proposals forward with the Department of Health, to rectify those issues that have been identified. Other important activity, paragraph 5 on page 7 of the report, a lot of work has been done to ensure that all providers that have been transferred, who transferred their registration into the 2008 Act, and all primary dental providers are correctly registered. So I know it sounds simple, but it's an important piece of work in that our register should reflect correctly exactly what people are registered for and the locations that they're registered for. So there's been quite a lot of work ongoing there between operations and our intelligence directorate. There's been a lot of work around exemplar notices, so the legal end, if you like, of enforcement activity, and making sure we've got some consistency across the organisation around that. There has been a lot of work in relation to an enforcement module in the induction process for new members of staff, the 8-week induction process. There's a good chunk there in relation to enforcement for new members of staff. And there has been some training in relation to PACE interview techniques. Now, we don't necessarily do a lot of prosecution work and criminal work. However, it's important that members of staff are aware of the rules around that area of work. Paragraph 6 of the paper on page 7, we've talked a lot today about the evaluation of the effectiveness of enforcement and the associated processes, and that just sets out really what we've already talked about and how important it is that we as an organisation can see the outcomes of the enforcement and the effect. Not a simple calculation, given deterrent and what have you, but an important one. So in summary, this is the first year of all activity, enforcement activity, being undertaken under the 2008 Act. We are seeking to evaluate the activity that that we have undertaken and that we will undertake moving forward. We can see from the figures that in the civil enforcement activity, it has remained fairly consistent throughout the operational year over the quarters. There has been an increase in the warning notice, the use of warning notices in the region, but I think that reflects an increased confidence with regard to using them and the number of return visits to establishments where we have not been satisfied and decided to serve a warning notice. So that's for you to know. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Louise, thank you very much indeed. Are there any questions? Martin.
Louise, I'd like to focus on Section 4, the limitations to the use of enforcement powers. We've had previous discussions around the board table about this issue, and we talk quite proudly to the world about our enforcement powers and how it makes us a tougher regulator than regulators in the past. But the reality is that the law ties our hands in terms of what we can do. Now, I assume the law was designed in that way. It was designed to, for us to have a more softly approach than sometimes we might feel is desirable as far as our duty to patients is concerned. You say you're having conversations with the department to rectify the situation. What does that mean, and how receptive is the department to the conversations you're having?
The conversation has been ongoing for some time, and we have proposed changes to the legislation that would enable us to deal with at least the second issue of regulated activities taking place across a number of locations. So we have put forward a number of recommendations which at the moment have not been accepted by the Department of Health. We continue to make the point, however, because we feel it's important to do so, and we know how the board feel about the issue. So we continue to make the point, but while we're continuing to make those points and press the issue, we can't sit on our hands. So we have to enable, have our thinking, be flexible about our thinking, I'm talking about the lawyers now really mostly, to be able to achieve the desired outcomes of our operational colleagues, perhaps just not doing it in the way that we'd like to if the legislation were plainer and clearer. But we are finding our way. It is, however, an issue that, as I say, we continue to talk about with the department.
Yeah. I wonder if the board needs to do anything to unblock this, because you know, it's great now that we've got some data, and when we present the data in the table under Section 3 to the department, which demonstrates that we don't in any way have a portfolio of enforcement actions. We've got essentially one enforcement action that we're using almost all of the time, which is warning notices. You know, that's data that might start making a much stronger case for where we want to go as an organisation. I'm wondering what the board needs to do to make that case more strongly.
That's a very good question, and let's return to it. And it's timely because there is a review being undertaken by the Department of Health, so we've got an opportunity. But Kay.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should, get to grips with that issue, and it'd be kind of helpful to know what the sticking points are actually, because I suspect it's probably at least in part political. So I think it would be quite, I don't know, but I mean, I don't actually know, but I think it would be, you know, it's always useful to sort of understand what others are thinking. So, you know, I think that would be useful for us to have. The other question I was going to ask, on the evaluation of the effectiveness of the enforcement powers, does that feed into the work that Martin's doing, or is it just a sort of discrete piece of work that we're doing on this? You know, is it featuring in your kind of research, or because it would seem relevant?
So yes, it potentially will be. When we look at our regulatory model, of which our enforcement powers are one component, and we draw up the logic model that Kieran Walsh is doing at the moment, it will identify this as one of the issues, and then it's up to us as a board to decide whether it's one that we want to prioritise. I suspect it might be.
Chair, if you don't mind, something I should say with regard to the enforcement activity that's presented here in the table, that I should have said before and I didn't, this does not represent the activity that's done notices of proposal to refuse applications for registration. So it doesn't reflect that, so it's not showing us how many we're pushing back at the gate, as it were, because their applications are not good enough or they're not fit to run a registered service. So it's not showing that, nor is it necessarily showing how many first-tier tribunals we have ongoing, which dots around the 12 to 15 number. So what is represented here might look like small numbers, but actually it's there is a reasonable bit of enforcement activity going on. Specifically, I think in that's why I dallied a bit on that last column, because there's a lot of significant work going on there, and that's one of the ways in which we're trying to use what we've got to get to the outcome we want.
That's very helpful. So if we could put these data into a wider context, it would be really helpful to us.
Just two additional points of information for the board. The first is it is covered in the paper, but we are doing a significant piece of work around our organisational approach to unregistered services. And we are going to be taking proposals to the executive team about shifting our focus on dealing with unregistered services that currently sits in compliance into our registration team, so that registration becomes a much more fundamental process in helping entry and exit into and out of the market. So I'll be very pleased to update the board over coming months about proposals that we're developing on unregistered services. And the second point, which Louise has partly touched on, is that the data doesn't represent the full extent of enforcement activity that is quite substantial that teams are undertaking, that forces other partners to interject. So, for example, we get to the point of we will issue a notice of proposal or we will place a variation on your registration, and Strategic Health Authority or PCT commissioners then take action. That means that we don't have to take our formal enforcement action. And what we need to be better at describing, both to the board but certainly to the public, is how we explain that it doesn't have to be the big stick. It's worth working in partnership that's sometimes as effective at driving improvement.
I've got two questions. The first is from my previous experience with reporting successful enforcement prosecutions for the public. It helps to translate the charge sheet into plain English so that people could actually understand what the person has been prosecuted for and what they did.
You mean this is not plain English, John? I don't understand.
I haven't conducted a fog test on the bottom paragraph on page 4, but I don't think it's going to get a crystal mark from the plain English campaign. What I think it means is that the particular care home group was not carrying out the needs assessments of service users. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Well, could I suggest that it might have been simpler to say that? I rest my case. The second question I have, it goes back to this fascinating subject of warning notices. And I just want to be a little sort of heretical on this. If somebody isn't doing that which they ought to, either through sins of omission or commission, and we issue a warning notice, if they put it right, then we've got a result. So, no problem. If they don't put it right, is there a time limit before we can take legal action, subsequent legal action?
If they don't put it right, in the warning notice, there is usually a time scale for completion of whatever we've asked them to do. So it might be 7 days, it might be 24 hours, it might be 3 months, depending on the issue. So when we get to we sometimes call it expiry of the warning notice, although that's not really what it is, but when we get to that date from where we've said this must be rectified, then we make a decision about whether we take further enforcement action going up the escalator, so the enforcement escalator. So we might then decide, depending on the breach, do we start a prosecution? Do we serve a notice of proposal to cancel or to vary? So while there isn't necessarily a drop-dead date on how long it's relevant, that timescale that we've given the provider to rectify the problems that we've identified is the key date from which we then decide which way we go.
Right. The reason I ask that is because, I mean, this is a very interesting conceptual analysis of the problem. What it doesn't tell us is whether this problem ever actually arises. I mean, how many cases would you like to have prosecuted, but you couldn't prosecute because the warning notice was complied with?
Perhaps if it might be helpful if I give an example of where this issue comes up. And it's in relation to those services where we see fluctuating compliance. So we may go into an establishment and say, that's not right, you've breached such and such a regulation, here's a warning notice, you've got 7 days to comply with it. They comply with it, therefore the warning notice has been, you know, as you say, successful, great. But in doing that, they are taking focus off a million and one other things, which makes them non-compliant in other areas. Or they may be compliant for the next week or so, but actually, once our backs are turned, they think, well, I'm not going to put so much effort into that. So what we call bumping along the bottom. So in the case where we have a bumping along the bottom provider and compliance fluctuates, if they comply with a warning notice, we lose that evidence. So we cannot refer to the fact that actually for 2 years, or the last 6 months, they've been non-compliant, compliant, non-compliant. We can't use the evidence in relation to those warning notices that have been complied with. So that's the, and we do have a number of those services that would be compliant, non-compliant, compliant, non-compliant. And they're actually the stickers for us. They're the ones where we actually need we need them to seize the issue of non-compliance and take a a straight view. So that's the sort of example that I would use.
So the real problem really is we get into this issue of sequencing warning notices. We just issue warning notices, complied, wiped, issue another one, wiped, and there's no way of breaking out of that cycle. That's what you're saying.
There is a way of breaking out of the cycle, and it would be to escalate the enforcement activity. And to think very carefully, and this again is one of the solutions that we try to use, to think very carefully about when we serve our warning notices. So actually, we might not serve so many warning notices, we might serve one warning notice, and in relation to a number of areas. And so I'm not explaining it very well, very elegantly, but we try to find ways around that. But there's no doubt that it is an issue that we would like to have rectified and we would like to work towards rectifying as part of the review of the regulations.
Thank you very much for everyone's contribution. That's been a very, very full discussion. What I'm hearing from board members is that the enforcement activity log is very useful if it could be extended to capture other information, potentially even more useful. So I think if the exec could take that away, that would be very helpful. And finally, I think a wish on our part for us to, and perhaps this is where David can write to the Department of Health, perhaps in conjunction with myself on behalf of the board, teasing out the difficulties and expressing our wish that it's entirely appropriate for the review of regulations to address this issue. And we might want to say that we've been asking for this over the last 3 years, and we now see this as the opportunity, and we've got evidence to support our view that a change should be made. Yeah, okay, that's very helpful. Well, just by coincidence, it's 10 past three, well, it's 12 minutes past three. So I think it's time for a cup of tea. Let's take a 10-minute break. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Well, welcome back to everyone, and let's move on with our agenda. So we'd got to item 13, which is the review of our complaints handling within the organisation. This is refers to complaints against CQC. And again, Louise will talk to this report. It's for us to note and to ask questions and comment upon. So, Louise, please.
Thank you, Chair. Quite correct in making this plain that this paper is in relation to corporate complaints. So complaints made about CQC to CQC rather than the other elements of complaints out in the system with regard to regulated services. This is to note and to comment or ask any questions. Page 3 of the report in the background, specifically at paragraph 1.2, sets out that CQC aspires to create a culture where employees automatically recognise and strive to resolve complaints. So right at the first contact, to resolve them there and then, and to have the toolkit and the skills and the knowledge to be able to do that. And it's a very important part of core business. The report then goes on to identify the supporting structure for handling complaints has been around since May 2009, although obviously it has been refreshed and reviewed periodically. And we have a two-stage model. Stage one is that local resolution stage, and where local resolution has not been possible, then we have a central complaints team who deal with and coordinate stage two complaints. So that's just to set out the background. We have, and I've mentioned this in 1.4, we have agreed targets for effective complaint handling at a local level, and we judge the effectiveness of resolving complaints at stage one against the number of complaints referred for stage two reviews. So we're constantly looking back to look at the detail of the stage one and how that was handled to see if there are any patterns in relation to how we're getting stage two complaints through. We also have the ability now to track that via region, and we work with regions where appropriate and where possible to feed back, again, that feedback loop of learning for those regions where perhaps they're having some difficulty. We appreciate these are not perfect measures, you know, how many go to stage two. Some individuals may always go to stage two, whatever the complaint and whatever the attempt at resolution, but it is a measure that that we use. The paragraph 2 on page 3 sets out a little comparison between the 09-10, 10-11, 11-12 complaints figures. And as you can see, there is a big jump between 2009-10 and then 2011-12. Two reasons for that, or perhaps three or perhaps more, but the two that immediately come to mind is that we are recording complaints much better in the organisation. So an inspector or a member of staff at NCSC will recognise a complaint when they're talking to someone on the phone or they're receiving an email and will log it as such. So that will account for some of the increase. Other elements, whenever there is a significant issue in the press, for example, Winterbourne View, we see a lot of complaints coming in. So Winterbourne View fell smack bang into 11-12 when we saw a lot of complaints coming through the system, and they were logged as complaints as such. So that is a very inflated figure there. One of the important ways in which we monitor how good we are or our progress in relation to complaints is how many complaints are actually resolved at stage one. and therefore people do not have to go through a further process at stage two and then potentially on to the Parliamentary and Health Services Ombudsman. And as you can see on at the top of page four, there has been a noted, an impressive increase in the number of complaints that were resolved at stage one. We're now at 91% for 11-12. Now, that's not necessarily to say that everyone went away entirely happy. Some people may have just decided, I've had enough, I'm not going to stage two. There will be some of that in there. But it's a good reflection, I think, of the improvement in the handling of those frontline complaints processes. Themes and trends, very... briefly on page four, we continue to have a lot of complaints about judgments made by individual inspectors. As I've set out here, this represents about 40% of the corporate complaints that we receive. Some providers, I think, see this as a second bite at the cherry in relation to, well, they've had their factual accuracy check. We've accepted some potentially, not accepted others, and they'll make a complaint about that. So they're almost having two bites of the cherry. So that paragraph relates to how providers are choosing to use the corporate complaints process. Another issue is individual providers not being happy about the way we press release warning notices. So when we've served a warning notice, we press release it. After a representations process, and they're not very happy about that, so we've had a number of complaints in relation to that. Then moving on in paragraph 3.3, delays and miscommunication and perceived failures, they are the usual sort of meat of complaints in an organisation such as ours. The lessons that we've learned, moving on to page 5, are... probably as you would expect, communication is a very important element of dealing with complaints. And we have, as an organisation, improved awareness of what a complaint is and what we should do with it and how we should deal with customers and providers that are coming to us with their complaints. And therefore, we think that that's why we have a greater satisfaction rate. We also now have a process where the outcomes from complaints are fed back to individuals so that they have an opportunity to learn from any complaints they've dealt with that perhaps haven't quite been resolved to the satisfaction of all parties. Ongoing improvements, we have national complaints panels now. And the purpose of the panels is to discuss complaints of a very complex nature. So the complaint might actually span operations, legal services, regulatory development. So we all get to, rather than dealing with in silos individual aspects of complaints, we get together on a national complaints panel to discuss those. We also discuss on those panels persistent complaints or vexatious complainants when we get to that stage in the handling of those. There's been considerable work with colleagues at the NCSC, which has borne fruit in relation to how we handle complaints. And there is now a complaints module in the induction programme, the 8-week induction programme for new inspectors. So we're getting in there early with regard to our approach to dealing with complaints. Ongoing activity in looking a little further ahead. The National Complaints Manager has been working with the head of NCSC and the mental health team to simplify and streamline the process for dealing with complaints from people detained under the Mental Health Act, which is a responsibility that we have under the Mental Health Act. We are also, of course, as colleagues are across the organisation, thinking about what Healthwatch England means for us in terms of complaints. So we are also working to produce a method of dealing with Healthwatch England complaints on their behalf. Just very briefly, at the very end, I should say that I've put in a reference there on page 6 in relation to the PHSO's report about the principles, certain principles of good complaint handling, about keeping processes clear, clean, simple, and easy to access. And they are almost the cornerstone of what we do. We've said rather boldly in the paper here that the CQC complaint handling process complies with this. But I think what we're saying is we think we're at the beginning of being able to say we comply with this, and we are obviously seeking ways to improve our performance.
Thank you very much, Louise. Any questions, comments? Okay.
Good. It seems we're making good progress on this, which is great. I wanted to ask a bit more about the points in 3.1, and you mentioned that it can be used as a second bite of the cherry. And presumably that isn't an appropriate use of the complaints procedure, but within that there may actually be issues of complaint. For example, if it was about an individual, because it could get a bit blurred, if it was about, say, for example, that a provider felt an individual inspector, say, didn't have the knowledge that they would want them to have to assess their service, you know, potentially that could be a complaint. But on the other hand, if they were trying to get the judgment changed, that wouldn't be a legitimate use. And it's, I guess it's, you know, how good are we now at, particularly when it comes to the interface of regulatory judgments and complaints, how good are we at sort of teasing that out and being clear which is which? Because sometimes it might be a bit of both, for example.
Yes, you're absolutely right. We do, you know, things are never clear, are they? Never clean. And often we do receive corporate complaints that have almost a foot in either side of that. The processes that I've referred to here in 3.1 about discussions taking place now to be able to look at a method for extracting the ones that are purely about judgment, or extracting the elements that are about the judgment taken, that is to go through complaints and identify which bits quite rightly fall within and which do not, so that the ambition is we get to a place where we can say this is in, this is out, or this part of it is in and this part of it is out. In practice, I think there are difficulties around that, and we're going to have to be quite consistent about our application of criteria when they are developed.
I guess quality assurance would come into it, and the audit and that kind of thing. Yeah.
A related question to Kay's under item 3.1. So if I'm right, there's about 200 complaints in the last year related to judgments made by individual inspectors, so 40% of nearly 500 complaints. How many will we need before we can start seeing patterns between inspectors or inspector teams? And I had no idea how to interpret those patterns. So if an inspector has a lot of complaints, are they unlucky, doing a very good job, or perhaps not doing a good job?
Well, exactly. I would say, yes, exactly. What we can tell from the data now is regional patterns. And I think it's possible that we can drill down from regions into compliance teams. But yeah, I think that we're able to do that. So we should be able to see where the hotspots are. The reasons for those hotspots, as you've quite rightly identified, could be many and varied. It could just be that an inspector is doing their job quite firmly and quite appropriately, but providers just don't like it. Or it could be that there is a communication issue, a relationship issue. It could be a number of things. So the purpose of looking at those trends and feeding back into operations and to the regions and to the teams is to identify where there could be problems from the data that we've seen, so that they can then look closely at what sort of activity is going on there, what is it about the way in which this team is working, or potentially that individual is working, that means that complaints come in about them, and therefore that the local team, therefore, and the manager will have management responsibility for identifying what the issues are and rectifying those, if indeed there are.
Like Kay, I would be a little worried, I think, if basically the complaint system was being used as an appeal mechanism for warning notices. And in order to understand this fully, is there an appeal mechanism for a warning notice or not? So, I mean, is it that they should be going somewhere there and they're coming here, or they're coming here because there is nowhere else to go? That's the first part of the question. And the second part of the question is just to help me understand the procedure. If somebody makes a complaint because they don't like the warning notice or the next stage, and your people look at it and say, hold on a minute, there isn't a valid complaint here about the inspector, this is just an appeal, how does that get counted? Is that a stage one resolution, or is it pulled out of the numbers, or does it disappear from the system? What actually happens to it?
Warning notices. There is no appeal against a warning notice. What providers do have is the right to make representations about whether we publish details about the existence of a warning notice and about the enforcement action taking place. So there's a representations process only about the publication, and this is because it's embedded in the regulations. So we specifically do it this way because that's what we're told to do in the regulations. And if we don't provide the representations process, we can't publish any details about warning notices. So obviously that would be an intolerable situation, so we provide a representations process. Other than that, there is no appeal or representations process about specifically that warning notice. So yes, it's an interesting point that perhaps it's going this way because it has no other route to escape to. Shall I cover the next bit? Yes. And really good question, really interesting question about how we count those stage ones and whether the ones that we filter out count. I think that the ones that we filter out are not represented in these figures. I'm looking at Alistair in case he has, he looks shocked. In case he has any information, do we count what complaints that we filter out?
I think my understanding is, I'll come back to you. Is that we are counting these because they are being logged as complaints, that we are forming part of it, and we're dealing with them as such. Yeah. So in that figure for the number of resolved, it will include those. Now, whether that's how we count it resolved, whether it means we've answered the question to the satisfaction or not, is the point, because we may still be pursuing the issue through a representations process as well. I don't think it necessarily means that we can say that the person has gone away completely satisfied.
Sorry, I've been gesticulated at because I've said all that without having the microphone on, so I'll say it again for the benefit of people who might be listening at home. The figures that we've got here, I believe, do include all of those cases where people are, rightly or wrongly, using the complaint system to raise this issue because there might not be any other legitimate avenue for them to do so. At what point we may then remove them from those figures if we make a decision at some point because we consider that's not been a legitimate use of the complaint system, I'm not sure. My understanding is we wouldn't at this stage because we would have recorded it as a stage one complaint. So that doesn't resolve the issue about whether or not it's a legitimate use, but I think it is a statement of fact about the numbers we recorded. As I say, if I'm wrong about that, I'll come back to you and correct it.
Right, so in the modern world, we're meant to encourage complaints. You want to hear more from people, and I'm not going to counter that at all, but we want them to be legitimate complaints. And there's certainly a tone here in 3.1 again, which says we're actually getting too many of this. And if we and I think John is probably right saying that it's instead of being able to appeal. But the question that John asked was about appeals against the judgments, and the answer you gave was appeals against warning notices, and they might not be the same thing always. So that's what I wanted to know, first of all, whether there is a difference. And so and there certainly shouldn't be an appeal against a warning notice, because that's an absolute measure against the judgment. So I think John's question still needs an answer. And the complement to that is would we benefit if we did do appeals to judgments, or would it cloud the issue? Would we spend less time on appeals than we spend on complaints? And would the process be better? But the question I think underlying that is, do we have any moderation of the judgments? because different inspectors will perform in different ways, and do we moderate those at all? That was that question, and I just wanted to talk about, I think 3.5 is something that I think we, if we could attend to that fairly soon and work out the messaging there, I think that is really quite important. Because it's about understanding our role and also allying us with what the public assume we do. Mm-hmm. And I quite understand why we can't.
Thank you. Sorry, I particularly thought that John said warning notices, but if it wasn't... The difference between 3.1 and 3.2 is indeed that one is about warning notices at 3.2,
yeah.
And 3.1 is just about judgments.
That's
judgment,
right.
Judgments made by inspectors. They normally appear in an inspection report. And what happens in the process of producing an inspection report is that the inspector goes, looks around, produces a report, allows the provider sight of the draft report so that they can make a factual accuracy check and not necessarily argue the, you know, the points made in, although they do. And then the inspector then considers which facts are actually correct and they missed them and which are not. And then we publish the final inspection report. There is no right of appeal against an inspection report because it is a judgment. It is a regulatory judgment from that inspector. Another aspect to it is we don't have such an appeal process, A, because it, well, I don't think it would be appropriate, but secondly, because the legislation and the regulations do not require it. So it's a different situation to other situations where we have representations processes embedded into the work that we do. What was the...
Moderation.
Yes. And Amanda, I'm sure we'll be able to tell you about that, but yes, there is.
Yes, there are a number of quality assurance and moderation processes. So for inspectors, their compliance manager does sample audits and quality assurance on their inspection reports. If we get concerns from a provider about an individual inspector's conduct or the judgments that they're reaching, then we would always try and resolve that through the relationship between the compliance manager and the individual provider before it escalated into a complaint. Again, that's not always successful. Where we are doing national programs such as the Dignity and Nutrition, we'll have a national moderation panel that will look at the consistency and the proportionality of judgments that are being taken in different parts of the country. Would we like to do that on every single inspection? In an ideal world, yes, but it is very time consuming and this is high volume activity. So I think we have to take a sampling approach.
If everyone's asked the questions they wanted to raise, I thank you, Louise, and for putting this to us. I think we have commented on the information. I think it raises some questions about data collection and data analysis that I hope you'll take away. And I think we should note that the issue in relation to investigation of complaints made by the general public, we've made some comments in our strategy about that, which again I think we're aware we may get some comments back through consultation, but we're aware that actually in overall terms the system isn't serving the public well at the moment, and that's not necessarily something to be owned by CQC. This is looking across at how the health and social care system works in its totality. So if we, as I say, note those comments. Thank you. That takes us to item 14, which is a report looking at the adult social care system reforms following the publication of Caring for Our Future, Reforming Care and Support, a white paper published in July. So what we're asked to do as a board is to, we've got a broad-based response here, which needs to go back by the 19th of October. So we're asked to agree that And also the board is asked to note the details of publications and the relevance of those to CQC. So, Philip.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, and also included in this is the accompanying draft bill. This is effectively a pre-legislative scrutiny process. And as you said, you have in front of you the broad view of how this might affect the CQC specifically, and those are set out on pages 4 and 5. I'm not going to go through those in detail, but I think probably just to highlight a few key points. There are points here about better regulation, which specifically look at the CQC's role, and also quality improvement initiatives, and this is an issue that's been discussed for some years now, effectively, within the CQC, and highlights not only our role but also the work of within the sectors and of a variety of organisations, not least, of course, the fact that NICE are now publishing standards in social care as well as within clinical care, and important to bear that in mind. There is a role, a comment around keeping people safe, and there's been a number of mentions today about the CQC's work around the track and chase system, and that's something that's specifically mentioned within the suggested changes here. The local market, Norman Lamb held a briefing yesterday about his proposals around local care markets, and there's a piece of work that's supporting that with ADAS and other organisations specifically to look at that. And I think also it's worth just mentioning that there's a broader point here about the skilled workforce, which is something that clearly is something that comes up for us with regularity. It's mentioned in the market report in particular, and the importance of the CQC, as we can currently do within our regulations, ensuring that providers are looking at minimum training standards, they're reviewing their workforce capability. There is a broader point within that, within this as well, which is this is very useful and timely in terms of the strategy review, because one of the issues is about differentiation in terms of the sectors. So I'm not going to add much more to that, but very happy to take comments. As you will appreciate, actually, the work in terms of the detailed response is already underway for matters of timeliness.
Comments from colleagues? Okay.
I was just sort of looking at the top of page 4 and those sort of I statements there. I am, I understand, which I think, you know, I think is a great way to sort of frame it. And I guess I feel that we could actually, that is something that we could really support, in the sense that we actually go and talk to people who use services, so people can actually say to us, I am supported, or I understand, or I'm not. And it's about kind of, you know, maybe in our response to particularly focus on the fact that we directly talk to people about their experience of care, first-hand experience, you know, so it directly feeds into that that part. And I think that's, I don't know if it's a unique selling point, but I think it's an important thing of what we do, to sort of really focus on that when we do our response, you know, so direct experience.
I think it's a very, very good point, Kay, and I would totally support that. That's the core of all of our inspection activity, and we need to make that clear that there's an alignment there.
Put it together. Sorry, we're agreed, we support it, and we'll delegate it to David and the team to take it forward. Thank you. Item 15 relates to accountability and governance arrangements for Healthwatch, and we're asked to approve the accountability framework and the standing orders. I will take it that everyone has read this, I know that it's been fully discussed with Healthwatch, I think we should, it is a decision, but I think I'd like to take questions from colleagues rather than go through what is a detailed report, but any questions?
Could I just be clear, Anna, if Anna were here, she would be supporting this paper and its recommendation.
And I asked her that specifically, John, and I should have said that she confirmed that was her position.
Report. I mean, Anna had a full discussion with us at ARAC, because Deirdre's not here either, so, but it was discussed in full detail, and I think very, very strong agreement.
Just looking at the memorandum of understanding, and I notice it's signed by the Healthwatch chair and the chief exec. Is that is it most appropriate for the chief exec to sign that? Well, maybe it is. I mean, it's obviously a complex sort of governance interface with Healthwatch, and I was trying to think of the fact that, do you sort of mean, it feels slightly, and maybe it's the whole thing, there's a bit of tension in terms of the governance. I just wondered, I don't know, it feels, I don't know. I just wonder if Healthwatch chair is a board member, and you're a board member, you're the chief exec as the accounting officer. Is that right? So that's why David would sign it, and that's the appropriate. Okay, that's fine. Yeah. I need to kind of understand that.
So in a sense, Kay, I think the thing that we've tried to tease out here, that Louise has been teasing out with Anna in terms of the wording here, is how can we signal that Healthwatch England would speak? And I think the language we've used is with an unedited voice, but be a subcommittee of CQC. And in that sense, part of the conversation over the past couple of months has really been about one of the ways that there can be an unedited voice is by Healthwatch and Anna speaking for Healthwatch on those issues, and therefore the umbilical cord back to CQC is effectively through the accounting officer relationship, where I would have to demonstrate to the Select Committee and therefore to Parliament that the money which is coming to CQC to go into Healthwatch is being used for the purpose it's been set out. That's a specific accounting officer responsibilities. But Anna will be responsible for the overall performance of Healthwatch. But the relationship is a dual one, and I think it is not a usual one, but nevertheless, that is the relationship we've got. And I think Louise and Anna have crafted I think a good and elegant solution which allows the accountabilities to be clear and discharged, and I hope we can explain that in a clear way to a Select Committee if we're called to do that. I think Anna, as Stephen is saying, is happy with that, which is why we've got that convention. It's not we're not trying to make any bigger statement than this is a practical way through those accountabilities and independence.
Thank you. Martin?
Could I just clarify two points? The answers might be here, but just to clarify it. So building on your point, David, in relation to holding to account for performance, there's no relationship between the Healthwatch England team and this board. So the Healthwatch England team reports to the DH for its performance, is that correct? I think that's what it says on page 10 under performance reporting section 4. Because it is, we've recognised the complexity of the relationship between the two, but this seems to be an important issue. Is this board responsible for Healthwatch England's performance or not?
So what we're trying to get at here is Healthwatch England as a subcommittee of this board, then this board needs to be fully knowledgeable of the performance, and that's the report that we took earlier in the agenda in relation to ARAC and Healthwatch and how that choreography of who is in what part of the meeting at what time and how that works its way through is the way that that's taken forward. The other way it's taken forward is that Anna's a full member of this board as well as the chair of Healthwatch, and I'm the accounting officer for you as an organisation, as CQC, but also because the money comes from DH to CQC for Healthwatch England, I'm the accounting officer. So I do not regard myself the line manager of the director of Healthwatch England. That person, whoever they may be, will account to Anna for that relationship. But I do
I am accountable for the overall performance of Healthwatch England and for the way that they commit that public money, not just how they spend it, but the theme from this board all afternoon has been, and what difference does it make? So it's not just how is the money spent, it's what is it spent on and what difference does it make? So what we're trying to do in this paragraph is actually get that quite fine distinction between Anna and the director of Healthwatch England are responsible for how it performs, as a count, but they are a subcommittee of this board, and therefore you do need to be aware of it, and that will get discharged from ARAC. Okay. Also, as a accounting officer, I need to satisfy myself, and I'll do that through ARAC, telling me that this is an appropriate way to go forward, that they're spending the money well, this is public money, and what they're spending it on is actually making the difference that Parliament wanted it to make when it set out the responsibilities in the health and social care legislation.
So I think that relationship was clear in the previous paper about the role of ARAC. I don't think it's clear in this section 4.6 on performance reporting, which makes no reference to ARAC at all. So maybe it would be
maybe possible to put
that in.
More on
I think that'd be helpful. My other question is relating to the Caldecott Guardian role, and I certainly welcome Healthwatch England having its own Caldecott Guardian. The relationship between that person and me as Caldecott Guardian for CQC needs to be worked through, particularly in relation to who signs off things like, I've forgotten the name of the documents that I sign off, I'm sorry, the various data responsibility forms that I need to sign on an annual basis. So that relationship needs to be worked through as well. And I'm assuming that it's me as CQC Caldecott Guardian that needs to sign them off.
These are all things that we will need to pick through, because they will. This is an extremely complex and unique, as far as I'm aware, situation. So as these issues, as we come across these issues, then we will need to very carefully pick our way through them. I absolutely agree.
Yeah, no further comments. So we are going to approve the accountability framework and the standing orders, subject to an amendment to paragraph 4.6, which makes the links across to the audit and risk assurance arrangements. And then, but separate to that, there's further work to do in relation to Caldecott Guardians and how they work together and what their different roles and responsibilities are. So you take that away. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Item 16.
Sorry to interrupt, but there are two other documents that we're seeking approval of today. That's Annex D, which is the Healthwatch England Members' Code of Conduct and Policy on Declaration of Interest, and the Annex E, which is the Healthwatch England Scheme of Delegation. Just for completeness, I don't. No one's asked any questions about it, but just to, for the minute.
We agree to both of them. Yes, okay, thank you. Item 16, this is the update on our scrutiny review action plan, which I think is regularly published on our website. And again, Jill, perhaps you take questions on this report.
Yes, I mean, happily, this report is now all but redundant, because most of what we have been most of what is in this report has now really been commented upon quite independently across the organisation. So we've already discussed, these are, just for members of our audience here, these are items that were identified as areas that CQC had to address as a result of its scrutiny. And the headlines are in the paper, and broadly speaking, the headlines now have either been delivered or have a life really of their own without being scooped up into this programme. So given that primary care has already been reported on, the activity reporting tool has continued to increase, and the rollout of that has continued across the field force. We have discussed the strategy and the rollout of that under David's report. We've discussed the use of clinical and professional associates under the corporate scorecard. We have discussed strengthening responsibilities as part of the board update of the unitary board. And we have already discussed recruitment of operations as well. So the only area where I feel we probably haven't updated as part of the board in general was the area around mental health operations of the Transformation Board that is now underway, which clearly is making very good progress. And Philip did just update me at the break to say that now that the Mental Health Act commissioners receive updates on the providers from the compliance inspectors, as to three of those four regions, they're now receiving those updates before they make their visit as a commissioner. And encouragingly, when a commissioner makes a visit, monitors the Act, their report goes into the compliance inspector's portfolio, and that triggers the compliance inspector has to look at that report before they themselves can make a visit. So significant headway has been made in terms of data exchange, in terms of Mental Health Act. And I know that for those of you who were there last night, you also heard a lot of encouragement about the amount of progress that had been made in relation to the Mental Health Act as well. So it's our intention for the next board just to assure the board that this is now being managed through independent work streams instead of having to report this as one separate body.
Yes, thank you. I don't want to prolong the meeting unnecessarily, but I think it's now becoming apparent that the actions fall into two types, at least two types. Type one are actions which, once completed, have achieved a single objective, or they are apparent through their continuing existence. So, for example, the public scorecard of existing measures being published is something that we now publish, so we all know it's continuing. Healthwatch England chair appointed.
Yes.
That's the action done, she continues. Some of them, though, one could classify them as type two actions, are designed to achieve a subsequent effect. A good example of that would be the dedicated team of quality risk and assurance managers, which has been created, but the key issue is whether it actually then delivers the purpose for which it was created. And there are a number of others that fall into that category. And I would just like to ask that at some point we have the reassurance of it being explained that those actions are delivering the purpose for which they were created. Because it's not otherwise going to be self-evident. It's not like the Health Watch chair, who we can see is still sitting in the right seat and things like that. But the dedicated team of quality risk and assurance managers, the enhanced bank of clinical and professional advisors, we need reassurance that those people are having the effect that led to their being created in the first place.
Can I take that a stage further? And I wasn't around when this program was started, and I don't really understand its genesis, though I can see that it was very necessary. But I don't think we should continue with an ongoing scrutiny review and internal audit and all the other things we're doing. So this exercise has got to have a start, a beginning, and an end. And I think then it would be for others to assess what that work has done. I mean, I think it's admirable work, very necessary, and I think, Jill and her team should be congratulated on delivering on all of this stuff. But I think the best thing we can say about it is we no longer need it, and I think we should be very pleased about that when that time comes.
Full indeed. Any comments, Martin? No. Okay, Jill, your final comment.
Absolutely right, John. Some of these lend themselves to being completed. Others were about changing the way in which we did business as an organisation, for want of a better expression. So I feel that the concluding paper that comes to the board should therefore provide assurance as to how they are to be continued and how you are to be assured through other mechanisms that they are being continued, not by us reporting this particular lens on activity, because it's a lens on activity that is mainstream, but that doesn't mean to say it's by any means done. So I will make sure that paper does that.
Further comments? Okay, let's receive that report. Thank you very much indeed. So item 17 is our staff survey. And these are the results from the 2012 survey. I'm going to hand over to Alison Beale to talk us through this. I don't know whether our colleague Helen McNamara is here, so could you join us, Helen? You might do well to. Where are you going to sit? Okay, there's a space for you. Thank you. Okay, so assuming Alison, are you starting? Oh, and then hand over to Helen. Thank you.
I'll broadly take you through the headlines in the paper and then not necessarily through every single annex because there's quite a lot of data in there. So I think what would probably be more useful is once we look at the headlines, and I'll take you through those, that we can then have a conversation and a debate about what the survey is telling us and what the next steps are. Okay, so these are the long-awaited results of the 2012 staff survey that we've been looking forward to. As you'll all know, GFK, the supplier, carried out the survey on our behalf in June and July this year. We had a very good response rate for a staff survey, so 80% of staff completed the survey compared with 76% when the last survey was carried out in 2010. A bit of background that it wasn't HR or GFK that wrote the questions. They advised us on some of the questions that we ought to incorporate, and we looked back at the survey in 2010. However, we set up a steering group to design the survey for us, which included trade union members, trade union reps, staff forum reps, people from the Home Workers Forum, and other employees. So we got quite a rich contribution from the entire workforce on what the survey should look like. So this wasn't us as an executive team imposing these questions on the organisation. This was employees in the organisation helping us to design it. So that's the background. I'm very pleased to be able to say that the results are a significant improvement in the results from the 2010 survey, where we had an employee engagement index of 41. This survey returned as a result of 55. So in terms of improvements, that is a significant increase. It puts us on a level on a par with what is generally seen as a public sector benchmark employee index, and we'll come on to that in a second. there were some particular areas where which saw the biggest the largest increases over that period. There's a couple of three examples there around how to access learning and development opportunities in CQC. There was a marked improvement in that across the piece. That people believe that CQC employees display the values of the organisation, that rose considerably. That people believe they have the opportunity for personal development and growth in CQC, again, that rose considerably. Then we've got the best scores that came out. There was very, very positive responses around teamwork generally, in terms of respecting and valuing each other and getting the support that they need from the team, and how they can manage outcomes together as a team. There was a good score in relation to the fact that people reported that they were having regular performance discussions and PDR meetings with their line managers. So that rose considerably as well. Now, whilst that's fantastic that we've gone up by 14 points on the index to 55, and that puts us in a good place, we don't want to rest on our laurels. There are a number of areas that we need to concentrate on now. We need to shine a light on some of the areas in the survey where we didn't do so well. We've highlighted some here. The question around morale was disappointing. That question had a 16% positive response rate, which isn't good. We didn't score very well on implementation of change or communications across different parts of CQC. Generally around communication, some of those areas let us down a little bit. Whilst it's not highlighted here, you will have noticed in one of the annexes, Annex B, that on page 35, there's a summary of the responses in relation to bullying and harassment. So again, we need to focus on what people are telling us about bullying and harassment in the organisation, do some analysis around that as we work our way through. How people reviewed the reward package in CQC as well differed quite a bit in different parts of the organisation, and also the response rate there reduced. What we need now to do is move into the action planning phase, and that's what I'm going to talk you through next in terms of what the next steps are and how we take this forward. I did refer earlier to the fact that this result of 55 sets us reasonably favourably when you look at the public sector benchmark, which is 56 that GfK use. I won't give you the data, but we've also measured ourselves against some of our more significant partners, and I won't give names, but we are scoring better or the same of some of the partners that we work with on a regular basis. So it's a great result. It's, you know, but as I said, we need to concentrate now on where we need to improve and also maintain and improve the scores that we're already doing well on. So in terms of next steps, there will be an extensive action planning process will commence in October. We will have a corporate action plan, which will look at the messages that this is telling us across the business, because it's not just about us building local recommendations to tackle things. There will be things that we need to address corporately. So there'll be a corporate action plan and then local action plans as well. The way that the data has been collected means that every head of function in the organisation will be able to have a copy of their own scorecard and results. So we've got, I think, round about 48 scorecards altogether. So we can cut and analyse this in quite a low-level way, which will be useful for people. So to support that, we want heads of function and directors to obviously take the next part of this process seriously. We've arranged a training session for the leadership team so that they can understand what the staff survey is telling them about their areas, but also give them some tips and advice on how they ought to take these results forward in their own teams to capitalise on the information they've got. There's a wealth of information that we've got supporting all this. We've got pages and pages and pages of qualitative information as well, which David has seen and Helen and I have done some analysis on. So again, there's lots of rich information in there that we need to analyse and decide what to do with, and that will form part of the action planning process as well. What we think this will also identify is, whilst there will be hot spots where we know we need to address some things quickly. So if you take bullying and harassment, for example, because of the way we can cut the data, what that will allow us to do is to see whether there are any specific areas of the organisation that we may need to sort of tackle more quickly than others in relation to some of these risky areas. We also will be able to identify more positively some areas of the business that seem to be doing very well and seem to be scoring well on communication and employee engagement. And what we need to do is look at how those parts of the business are operating so that we can ensure that the rest of the organisation, if it needs to, can learn some lessons from those approaches. We've also asked our supplier to do us a cut of the data in relation to office workers and home workers, so that what we can do with the home workers' information is see whether or not that's telling us something different for the group of staff that we've got working at home. Helen is going to the home workers forum tomorrow with the information. They meet regularly to discuss home workers issues generally, but tomorrow this is certainly on the agenda to discuss. Interestingly, the home workers employee engagement index came out 53, so not significantly different, but when you actually look at the answers to some of the questions, there are some hot spots again where perhaps we need to shine a light and do some things quickly for that group of staff. We're going to continue our engagement with the staff forum and the trade union, all of this. We've already had a conversation and dialogue with the trade union about the results. You'll remember as a board that we talked at an earlier board meeting about the Unison survey that was carried out and how there were some concerns raised in that survey, albeit it was quite a small sample size. What we agreed to do at the time was that we would come back to that survey once we'd carried out our own survey to see whether or not some of the messages that they'd found from their members corresponded to the information that was emerging from this survey. And that's exactly what Helen's now doing. So we haven't just put it in a drawer and forgotten about it. We've done what we've promised that we would do with them, and we're addressing that now with the trade union reps. We are committed to doing a survey every year now. David's made me absolutely promise that, and I'm sure it will be in my personal objectives. We now need to enter into a really meaningful dialogue with staff to get behind the reasons why some of the scores are low, to understand what the issues are. Is it corporate? Is it regional? Is it in specific teams? And develop some action plans around that. My team of HR business partners are going to be engaging with each director, with each head of function, to make sure that action planning happens and is taken seriously. We have a timetable which we're adhering to make sure that we keep on track. Today was on the timetable, so we're very interested to hear your feedback on whether or not you think our next steps feel and look right. We have an action planning, corporate action planning workshop planned, I think it's around about the second week of October. I've already had a conversation with Joe and with David to see whether or not it will be of interest for a commissioner to join us at that session, so that we've got some early input and insight from a commissioner's perspective. And I'm pleased to say that Kay has agreed to come along and represent the commissioners at that meeting, and to continue to engage with me as we work through the process, which I think will be valuable. So I'm going to stop there. We've got lots of detail in here. I don't plan to go through everything page by page, because I'm assuming that you'll have had a flip through and read it. But it's really just to, I guess, discuss and see if there's any questions.
Many thanks, Alison. Comments, questions from board members. Martin.
So well done. Mm-hmm. I think this is overall good news, in so much as we're heading in the right direction as an organisation. Strongly support our commitment to do this annually. It's really only helpful if you do it annually. So I think that's great. With all the positive results, it seems slightly disingenuous to focus on a negative bit, but that's our job. And clearly, the bullying bit is a concern that I'd like to know more about, because I'm not really sure I understand it. I can't correlate this apparent level of bullying with the very positive results in other parts of the survey. So I guess I'd like to understand the relationship between the two. And I don't know whether the questions that were asked to the staff are the questions that's presented to us here. Because if it says, for example, whilst working at CQC, I've been bullied or harassed at work, is that in the last year or ever? Because if it's ever, then these results are kind of meaningless to us. If it's in the last year, that's a great concern. Yeah. So I need to know a bit more specifics about the questions that were asked.
Okay, yeah. Shall I respond?
Well, sure. Do you want to see if there's any...
Let me see, John.
Not immediately, not yet.
Yeah.
Okay. Obviously, I'm very pleased that the staff survey has been done. And I can obviously, there's some real improvements there, and that's good. I do think there are some underlying issues that we need to get to grips with, and I'm very pleased to be asked to be part of engaging, working with HR staff to get to the bottom of that and to move forward. I think what I also wanted to say that, and it goes back to my other point, that Mental Health Act commissioners were not part of the survey. I'm presuming that second opinion appointed doctors weren't either. And I feel that we should include them in the survey, actually. You know, I mean, I know they're not full-time employees, but I think it would send a signal that they are important and part of CQC.
Next year we can do that? As Alison said, we can cut this in all kind of different ways.
We can. I mean, I've no problems with it. I mean, it would be interesting to see what their views are, I think, Kay. We may need to tailor it slightly, because there will be some questions,
yeah, I
guess, which won't be relevant. I mean, there's nothing to stop us, of course, you know, if and we can perhaps talk about this outside of the meeting, David, whether or not we wanted to do a survey of that group of people, but do something very specific around the questions. So perhaps we can pick up that outside the meeting. Okay. But certainly I'm not at all averse to that suggestion.
Yeah. No, I mean, I want to say, I think, you know, the really positive thing is around the teams and how they work together and support each other, which I think was actually part of the previous survey, but is, you know, was reflected in the previous survey, and it is in this one, and that's, you know, very definitely a very strong positive. I mean, I sort of did compare back to the survey in 2010, and I know that in terms of leadership, we've gone for sort of line managers and, you know, immediate leaders. And I can understand that in the sense that it's important to sort of understand leadership behaviours across the organisation. But I feel, I mean, personally, I feel that we should include some very specific questions about the board and the executive team, because it was a really big issue in the 2010 survey. And I'm quite disappointed that it wasn't part of this survey. And I think that we should consider that, actually, as we go forward.
Yes, my question was really about the future, rather than this particular survey. And it was, you very helpfully, Alison, explained to us what the public sector benchmark at the moment was and our score in relation to it. And I was going to ask, as a target for you and David, to aim for what the threshold for the upper quartile benchmark was.
We have the data on the better performing public sector organisations, and that's round about 65. So were we to want to aspire to the higher quartile of those public sector organisations, and that would be the figure that we may be looking to match, and I believe that's achievable. I think we should set our sights on that, definitely. Do you want to do Martin's question?
Yeah, I can respond to Martin's question around bullying and harassment. The questions in the survey weren't time-bound at all, so there wasn't a 12-month period.
Any questions?
No. And actually it was something that we debated quite long and hard at the steering group, and it was something that the staff felt quite passionate about, that because we hadn't done a survey last year, that they wanted the entire time that they had been at CQC to be reflected in that question. We did debate it quite a lot at the time, and we said that we would honour that commitment to say that, okay, we would take at this point in time that entire time period, and then maybe when we go to do a more annual survey, that we can make it more time bound now that we've got this kind of mark in the sand, I suppose.
So my sense is that I think as a board, we're simply asked to discuss, which I think we've done in some detail here, but the real issue is picking upon the things that we need to nail and improve upon. And Alison, you talked in some detail about those opportunities. And I just wonder if it's going to be possible for us to, of course, the next survey will be a tangible measure of whether or not improvement takes place. But in terms of the action, is it possible to identify measures that are able to demonstrate that things are moving in the right direction? I'm just wondering, you know, people have been working very hard in a number of areas. How do we know that the actions are addressing the issues? So it's that ongoing monitoring of the programme of change that I think I'm interested in.
I should have probably added, actually, as I was talking you through it, that we are committed to do a series of pulse checks as we work our way through the year. So what we don't want to do is just have an action plan and then just assume everything's going perfectly and then get to the next survey and we get a nasty shock. So We will, as part of this process, be doing a series of pulse checks as we go along. How we focus those and what we focus them on and how we do them, it will be determined once we've developed the action plan.
Really good. Okay, well, I think you've got the full support of the board in moving forward on this. Kay's going to get involved in very directly in a particular piece of work, which I'm sure will enable you know, our views to be taken into the executive work. And you know, it is about acknowledging real progress and a desire, I think, to keep going and making, you know, as Tracy Forrester said last night, really, you know, this is a real place of choice for people to come to work. Thank you.
Sure, and I wonder whether my next public board meeting is December, and I wonder whether there's a component to my... Next public board meeting is December, and I wonder whether a component to my chief exec's report should give you the update on where we're at on terms of the action plan. So rather than getting to serial reporting, just keep this in your view as a development aspect and just pick up on the themes that Alison set out, particularly the action plan and the pulse survey. So not a lot of process, but the action plan and the pulse survey are probably what you would want to see. I think pulse surveys on a small sample of the organisation, on the key probes we want to get satisfaction on, perhaps three or four times in a 12-month period is really the way to see whether what we're doing is getting into the right space, and that's how to keep it alive, I think. So I'm very optimistic about this. I think the other thing that Alison didn't touch on, one of the things we asked GFK to do, the company that ran this survey, I think it's probably worth just teasing this out, is amongst the database, have they got any other home-based organisations that we can benchmark against? And the answer is no. So in a sense, it makes a point virtually about the uniqueness of this organisation and the issues we're trying to deal with. And that's no reason not to do this and to be really rigorous about it. I think the challenge about top quartile, I get that to be about 60, Alison, personally. But anyway, let's come back to that. Actually, we're not on that. We can benchmark ourselves, but actually, there isn't an equivalent that has the number of people that we've got as home workers doing the things that our staff are doing that would allow us to benchmark. So we are working this through for the first time. And the beauty, I mean, you shouldn't do a commercial contract in public, should you? But the beauty of having the same type of organisation do this year on year is you can actually get that continuity and veracity of the methodology, etc., working its way through. So.
Thank you very much indeed. I now want to move to item 18 and ask you to receive the board forward plan. Item 19 is just a moment to pause and review the meeting. It's my opportunity to thank everyone for their contributions this afternoon and to thank people who've been here with us for, staying the distance and listening to what's been going on. I hope you found it helpful. And to those people who've been watching and who will watch in the future, I hope that this is has been an opportunity to find out a lot more about the work of CQC. But again, thank you for everyone's contribution, and I'm going to close the meeting. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.